August on this Thursday edition, 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones, and everyone I talk to, including mainline liberals, are blown away by the wall-to-wall lies and disinformation being launched against the Republican Party nominee Donald J. Trump. They floated this months ago that he was going to drop out of the race. And he comes out and says, I've never talked about it. It's not happening. They floated it months ago that his kids didn't like him and that his campaign was falling apart. None of it was true. And now they've come out. I was watching cable news last night and went through like 7 or 8 channels. And I would basically finish the sentence as I would flip as they kept saying, oh, he might take a payoff to drop out of $150 million. Insiders tell us, oh, he's dropping out. Oh, Hillary's 20 points ahead now. On and on and on. And then by the day, it's just, oh, what would happen if he did? No one has pointed this out. We're doing a story about it. I shot a video this morning on it. Remember what happened in Iowa when Ben Carson at about 5:30 in the afternoon knew he was in second place? Got on an airplane to fly to Florida to start campaigning. And they went on the news, Ted Cruz's people, and tweeted out that, well, Ben just told us he's dropping out. He's flying home. And then later they had to admit they did it as a dirty trick, and he fired the campaign head that supposedly did it. This is the Republican Party inside with the mainstream media putting this out. They just come out and say, oh, Trump's dropping out. Did you hear? Or, oh, the Koch brothers might give him $150 million. And Trump comes out and says it's totally untrue. In fact, I pulled up a Politico article. You just type in Trump not dropping out. I pulled up an article from over a month ago on 6/19/16. Would Donald Trump really drop out for $150 million? And then they just admit it's total speculation. They have been putting this out. And then Donald Trump says in the article, please print it for me, guys. He says, this is the lies of Politico. How dare you make this up? But then I saw articles today saying Trump won't deny he won't take $150 million. They are preying on the public, just like they did with Ben Carson, saying he gave up. He's given up. It's over. He can't win. And then I have all the articles here admitting that Reuters and others go out as soon as Trump got 10 points ahead a few weeks ago. And they will sample 10 to 15%. Reuters admits it. I'm going to show you the graphs. You're a TV viewer. From them, where they go out and they sample 10 to 15%, depending on the poll, more Democrats, and then suddenly claim she's ahead. Well, of course, if you get 15% more Democrats. I mean, I could go out and sample just Democrats and claim it's a poll and, you know, say that Trump's going to get 3,000% if I wanted to. Or that Hillary is going to get 3,000%. 650 Democrats is who they sample. And then Republicans, 496. You see that? That's like 15% more Democrats. This is how they operate. And it's never before been seen like this with this level of out-of-control corruption. Now, the truth is Hillary Clinton is acting completely mentally ill and completely insane. Bill Clinton looks completely out of his mind and like somebody out of a horror movie. He looks like a zombie. He looks like he's dead, like he's Lazarus. The video's up on Infowars.com. Paul Watson's done a report on this. And he links to the experts and others that are saying she is obviously completely out of her mind. And that's not hype with us. You can look at her. And look at the statements. I mean, she is cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. And can you imagine if she gets in, steals the election, is in control of the nuclear codes? I just have a really bad feeling about this. I've never been more concerned. I'm not really afraid of her. I mean, if God wants the earth to get nuked and all of us to die, that's God's issue. And maybe Hillary Clinton is the judgment. The horror of revelation. We have Roger Stone, former Trump campaign head, joining us at the bottom of the hour. You notice Trump has come out and said that Hillary Clinton is the founder of ISIS. We put that report out 3 years ago because she was the founder of ISIS. And that's what's got the establishment so scared. They know Trump is dialed in to the InfoWar. He doesn't get his information from us. He knows our information is accurate. And I've actually known this for a long time. The enemy's finally figured it out and is in full panic mode. And I'm not trying to ingratiate us with the public and say, oh, look how big InfoWars is. I'm telling you what we've been basically keeping secret for a while. But there's no point in doing that now. This information is liquid death to the New World Order. It is poison. It's the blood of life to liberty. It is death. Coffin nails to the globalists. We understand their program. We understand their players. We understand their operations. Trump has set the stage to expose election fraud, just as he blocked the attempt to steal the primary from him. That has got them in full pull their hair out, panic mode, White House press conferences, foreign leaders, the Pope, the communist Chinese, all saying you better not elect Trump. And you turn on CNN, even Fox, MSNBC, ABC News, it is over the top compared to their over the top lies just a week ago. It is exponential deception. And it goes along with them covering up the latest jihad attack in London. One dead, five injured, stabbed as he screamed Allah Akbar. And ISIS takes credit. And ISIS supporters celebrate Russell Square terror attack. And the Islamic mayor says, be calm, do what you're told. We have total economic collapse happening in many areas of the world. The economic collapse in Venezuela is so bad that people are slaughtering and eating zoo animals. That's the wonders of communism. We've got the latest on our economy here. We've got Politico trying to claim that Donald Trump's wife was an illegal alien or did something wrong. We've got Clint Eastwood coming out, says that he's challenging Obama's pussy generation. Just effing get over it. I don't normally paraphrase profanity here on air, but when Clint Eastwood says it, it's not profanity. Now, let's get to the heart of the issues here. I'm going to go over not just news, but the actual polls that Reuters and others are giving to the respondents. And they begin with generally 15, but the lowest 10% more Democrat respondents in a poll. Now, you're supposed to, if you're going to poll people, you do it randomly or you do it 50-50 of registered voters. This has never before been done. They've got phone lists and target lists where they really know there's more Democrats. That's how they do these spin polls, how they create the perception that Trump's behind. He was 7 to 10 points ahead, even with their cook polls. So they came out 2 weeks ago and started putting these fake polls out. And we've talked about it. But it's being done at a level never before seen where they just admit they're sampling 650-something Democrats versus 400-something Republicans, obviously that's going to create 10-point leads for Hillary Clinton, bare minimum. This is not rocket science. And you got to ask yourself, the dying enemy media, where is it going next? Because yesterday, I was here monitoring news here in Austin and then traveled to a nearby city to do research. And I was monitoring more news than I normally do because I wasn't on air. And I was collating news articles and data for special reports and things we're putting out about election fraud, about the fake polls, about the rigging of Google, blocking Donald Trump's name from the presidential selection when people do research. Again, unprecedented stuff beyond the old Soviet Union. And every radio channel, every TV channel was saying, Donald Trump's dropping out, have you heard? And then I heard people on the street talking about it. First it was, he is dropping out. I go, look, Trump says it's not true. I find out over a month ago, Politico came out and said he was going to be paid $150 million to drop out. Total bull. He says, he responds to them on Twitter and says, you are totally full of deception. You are liars. Asked about whether Trump would drop out. Another former Trump advisor, Jim Doran, Soto, he believes he might. But then, oh, let's hear from Trump down here. Trump himself says it's a ridiculous proposition and that it's not a fan of the question. The story is a total fabrication from you and Politico as usual, the New York billionaire said in an email sent by his campaign manager. And then it goes on from there. I will never leave the race. Nobody has enough money to pay me to leave the race. And if they did, it would be totally illegal anyways. Did Obama and the Clintons get you to write this garbage? And now we have the emails. This came out before the emails, 2 weeks before, where they are directing Politico and ABC News and CNN. You got Wolf Blitzer up there singing and dancing, drinking champagne when Hillary's up there acting like a mental patient swatting at balloons. The archetypal creeping witch. In fact, this is getting so fantastical, we're seeing an elite meltdown and burn down right now. Whatever happens with this election, the Anglo-American establishment's done. They have blown it all out. They've discredited themselves. You can say the mainstream media is now dead. It's over. You have a 6% trust rate in national polls, AP. You already know that. But you really, I guess, had nothing to lose now that you're all discredited with a bunch of lackeys and weirdos in your cult that thinks you can tell us we didn't build our businesses and families are bad and we're evil because we're hardworking. You are disconnected from reality. Obama's out in a new video clip we're going to be playing where he talks about anti-government people just need to leave America because it's the government that created all the industry and all the jobs. Like General Motors. No, it was the government that bailed out the corrupt corporations that did pump and dumps. The government is not the reason we had some prosperity. It was limited freedom and limited innovation and limited capacity to have a little more freedom than other nations. If government delivered heaven on earth and nirvana and Valhalla, cloud nine, then they wouldn't be eating the zoo animals in Venezuela as Venezuela collapses into zombie land. Venezuela is now hell on earth. And get ready for it here, down the road. And then after they've looted every farm, looted every business, after the socialists have brought the country down, the elites have already moved out, life will start back over again. I don't know how many years down the road this is, but we're a far cry from the bottom of the rat hole yet. But don't worry, it'll be a long, arduous, painful, humiliating, stinking fall with the rise of ignorance and deception. Already we rival Mexico for kidnappings and every other form of slovenly corruption. And meanwhile, they come out in the last 24 hours, massive 2016 campaign shakeup, Trump to be replaced. That's what Politico, the New York Times, everybody were saying. First it was, he is being replaced. Did you hear? He quit. Just like Ben Carson. In Iowa, he gets on a plane 5:30 in the afternoon. All right, I'm going to the next state. We're in second place in the polls. Looks like we're going to maybe be the nominee. And then out comes the rhino Republican establishment. Ted Cruz, people put out the fact, oh, we just talked to him. He's given up. He quit. He threw it in. He's in a two-hour flight. During the 2 hours, he drops in the polls. People stop voting for him at the key voting time. Ted Cruz gets in. Ted Cruz gets second place. And it's the same thing we see here. Did you hear? Did you hear? Trump quit. And Trump's come out repeatedly and said, this is preposterous, as I've been saying for months. This is a talking point, but now the whole media is pushing it. It's all lies, and none of them will say on the news that Trump has come out and said it's not true. They lie and then won't even let you hear him say it was a lie. You know this criminal media is going to go along with banker bailouts, bank holidays, nationalization of labor, like they've done in Venezuela. We're going to be in a living hell with these people. They just keep lying and lying and lying. Could Donald Trump drop out? Some bettors seem to think so. New York Times today. Trump campaign in turmoil as aides stop channeling, challenging the mogul, and top Republicans begin exploring ways to replace him on the ballot. Oh, the Republicans are back saying we want to replace him on the ballot, as if you could do that legally. But they just sell the idea. Oh, did you hear? You can't have him. Oh, did you hear? Oh, that's not available now. No. Hillary is. There it is. GOP officials exploring options if Trump drops out. Well, we've got big Hillary news on the other side of this break. You'll want to tell your friends and family to tune in right now. This is one of the biggest announcements ever. Straight ahead. Stay with us. There's been massive coverage in the last 24 hours in the mainstream media claiming that Donald Trump is planning to drop out. Now, Trump has come out and said that he never said this. There's not turmoil in his campaign and that it's not true. But the MSM from Politico to the New York Times says that they do have the sources and that it's happening. So you can just forget about voting for Trump. He's not going to be on the ballot. The Republicans are going to replace him. Doesn't matter that that's completely illegal and they couldn't do it. They're just telling us this now. They earlier tried to say that it didn't matter if he won the states by landslides, California by 78 points, that still it would be given to Ted Cruz. But for some reason, voters didn't support that, so they had to back off. But ladies and gentlemen, here is the big announcement. And we have the report right here for you. It's actually Hillary Clinton that is going to be dropping out of the race. She is due, in fact, to drop out tomorrow. Hillary Clinton is due to drop out of the race tomorrow. And there you see the New York Post. Hillary to drop out due to criminal probe. And we have a clip that we're going to play coming up where Julian Assange has put out a statement saying that when the next information comes out, she will be indicted because it's absolute proof of her criminal activity. The last WikiLeaks, of course, was them sending out Bernie Sanders dressed Clinton supporters to attack Trump supporters so that they could shut down Trump, make him look violent, but also make Bernie's people look violent. And of course, it was Roger Stone exposed that back when that first happened about 4 months ago in Chicago. So Hillary to drop out due to a criminal probe, ladies and gentlemen. And that dovetails with what Julian Assange said about a week ago, and RT reported on that. Again, we're going to play that in a moment. So there you go. It's Hillary is actually to drop out due to criminal probe, and also because she has a brain tumor the size of a large watermelon. Also, Hillary is to drop out due to the fact that she was caught getting money from the Koch brothers, $150 million, to drop out. So she's being bought off by the Koch brothers for $150 million. And also, her husband, Bill Clinton, is an illegal alien. And also, she's very racist. And also, she doesn't like Hispanics. And also, she's a Russian spy. Of course, in that case, it's really true. The Wall Street Journal admits she did deals with her foundation that nobody else could for uranium and weapons to Russia. So that part is not satire. And yes, folks, this is satire. It's not satire that Julian Assange says the next leak will get her indicted for sure. I'm not sure about that. I think Hillary, because the mainstream media is behind her, and because she does have a small minority of cult followers, and by minority, I mean a bunch of whacked out crazy people of every race, color, and creed, that she basically has Hitlerian control over her minions, and they'd put up with anything from her. As you watch this and hear this, it is absurd to come out here with fake New York Post headlines saying Hillary to drop out due to criminal probe. It is absurd to get up here on air and say she has a brain tumor the size of a watermelon. I'm sure it's much smaller. It is absurd to sit up here with no proof and say that. But that's what Politico and the New York Times and everybody else is doing. Thousands of publications yesterday and today saying, what do they do if he drops out? Republicans may replace him. Insiders say his sons are mad at him. None of it's true. The same lies over and over and over again. ABC, Good Morning America, is saying it. The New York Times is saying it. They're all saying it, and there's no truth to it. So it goes from he's going to drop out for sure to what happens if he drops out. This is how they run scams. Just like Ben Carson, when they announced when he was on an airplane, the night Iowa took place, oh, Ben just told us he's dropping out. Vote for me. You know, good job, Ben. Good showing. Glad you endorsed me, Ted Cruz. Remember all that? Ted Cruz campaign spread false report in Iowa that Ben Carson was quitting race. This is the same thing, but bigger. Where's the controversy? Where's the anger that they've put out fake headlines? Now, again, I'm doing this as satire to show you a fake headline. You watch the media is going to be bad saying that I'm evil because I haven't talked about this. But all I'm doing is illustrating what they've done and put the shoe on the other foot. Now, when we come back, I have the news articles, and I actually have the Reuters polls and others where they'll sample 15 percentage points more for Hillary. 15 percentage more Democrats than they do Republicans they sample to show her 10 points ahead. This is the most naked fraud we've ever seen. Why not say Hillary is 3,000 points ahead? Well, back in late June, Politico just came out and said Trump was being paid $150 million by the Koch brothers to drop out. Trump came out and said, you're total liars, total fabrication. Number one, that's illegal. Number two, I'd never give up. We're winning. I read his quotes earlier. But they don't care. They're back everywhere saying he's going to drop out. By today, they went, will he drop out? Because he's so far behind. Hillary Clinton, ladies and gentlemen, was 10 points behind when Reuters and others, and I'm going to cover this here in a moment and go to our guest, started coming out and adding 15 percentage points more of Democrats that they knew were registered Democrats that they were calling in the phone sample. In fact, I have a computer shot here of the Reuters poll for TV viewers. 650 Democrats, 496 Republicans. That's upwards of 15% more. Of course, you're going to see Hillary Clinton ahead. And that's what they're doing all over the place. Or they, in other polls, give her the independent votes. I mean, it is amazing. I've never seen more corruption, not even in the old Soviet Union, not in communist China. This is unprecedented. So we've put out the headline. New York Post, Hillary to drop out due to criminal probe. Because Julian Assange has come out and said the next group of emails to come out, I wish he'd release them right now, has her involved in criminal activity directing it. Well, we already have enough with the last data dump for that to happen. So that's why this is so important. Let's play that clip.
Julian Assange is now preparing to release more leaked emails, and this time he says they will, quote, provide enough evidence to indict Hillary Clinton. Assange also made it clear there is no evidence of Russian involvement in the email hack, despite the Clinton campaign's claims. For details on this story, we go now to Laura Smith in the UK.
Julian Assange, the founder of WikiLeaks, of course, is still holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy here in London. But once again, he's proven that he's not just sitting there twiddling his thumbs. Not content with releasing 20,000 emails from the Democratic National Committee, Assange now says he'll be releasing more material that he says will provide enough evidence to see Hillary Clinton arrested. He's given a series of interviews in which he says that there's no...
And that's what he put out via a text press release, obviously a week and a half ago. But there's more evidence that she will be stepping down because of a criminal probe than there is that Trump would, because there's no evidence of that. It's totally made up out of whole cloth. But I tell you, I'm going to fight fire with fire. And I'm giving our audience fair warning that I'm going to do what they're doing now. Every time they do it, I'm going to put it out on the mainstream media, but then tell the audience as a proviso that I'm an example of what they're doing. See, these are not dirty tricks on our side. We're showing you what the dinosaur media is up to. The way they're manipulating. I mean, look at these Reuters articles, and then we're going to our guest. Look at this. Pat Caddell on Crooked Reuters poll. Never in my life have I seen a news organization do something so dishonest. They're even backdating old polls with a new methodology that no one's ever done of using more Democrats than Republicans for some reason. They're even memory-holing stuff now. The old Soviet Union would go back into newspapers and microfish, you know, out people's photos. They blur them out of photos. Reuters radically changes methodology to favor Clinton. Another report on that. More polling tricks. New Reuters poll extremely skewed. Reality shows Trump tied with Hillary. I even disagree with that. He's way ahead of her because most folks are closeted. But now they're trying to create the illusion that Trump is behind to create a bandwagon effect so people think they've got to get behind the winner. Meanwhile, there's a video up on Infowars.com with psychiatrists, psychologists, and others, plus the video of Hillary obviously out of her mind at a whole bunch of different events and people asking her, are you okay? This is a borderline personality disorder person with a serious capacity for psychotic breaks, which before she would have every few days, according to the Secret Service, and I don't just mean the ones on the news, people I know, and not just the FBI, but now she's having breaks many times a day. And she goes between thinking she's a god and invincible to hating everyone around her. Classic borderline personality disorder. And again, borderlines go into these psychotic breaks. They're not psychotic all the time, but they have these psychotic moments, especially when triggered by stress. We're going to give the nuclear launch codes to this person that never built anything or did anything in her life, but a trail of carnage and destruction behind her. So we're going to take the last 10 minutes where I came in and said, big announcement, Hillary Clinton is stepping down tomorrow due to a criminal probe. That is to illustrate how much the mainstream media is lying. But in her case, we actually have evidence that at least points partly towards her down the road if these WikiLeaks documents come out. Assange hasn't exaggerated. He's been pretty conservative. So this must be bombshell material. What are we going to do then? Of course, we know what the documents are. We already have our sources inside the CIA and inside Defense Intelligence and others. General Flynn's gone public as well, former head of Defense Intelligence. And that's that Hillary the whole time was shipping weapons to Al-Qaeda and then had the name changed to ISIS. And now Donald Trump has come out, we're going to play the clip later, and said she's the founder of ISIS. I'm very proud that I'm the coiner of that term 3 years ago. You can Google it. Hillary Clinton is the founder of ISIS. Trump now not copying us. That's the reality. Roger Stone, former Trump campaign head, Trump confidant, best-selling author. Author of The Clinton's War on Women, available at InfoWarsStore.com, and the new Bill Clinton rape shirt. You've been in 9 different campaigns inside 4 administrations. You were part of the Florida recount. You're a vote fraud expert. StoneZone.com. You've heard what I've been saying the last 5 minutes. Roger Stone, is there any doubt we are at the most epic moment ever, not just in U.S. politics, but world politics? I have never seen something this crazy. I have never seen something this over the top. I have never seen mainstream media go this wild and crazed. Is this a sign of strength or a sign of desperation?
Well, Alex, first of all, it's great to be back with you. I flew in from Los Angeles last night, got into Miami about 5 a.m., and therefore I haven't seen a lot of the press. And then this morning when I went online to prepare for the show, it boggles the mind. I've never in almost 40 years in American politics, seen anything like this. I mean, the tactics that were used against Barry Goldwater, you know, 1,000 psychiatrists say Goldwater unfit to be president, famous headline. Nothing compared to this. I spoke to Donald Trump yesterday. He's in good spirits. He has no intention whatsoever of dropping out. You can say anything you want about Trump. He's not a quitter. He's a brawler. He's a fighter. And this is 100% disinformation. Is it coincidental that ABC, who seems to be taking the lead in reporting this falsehood, is the home of Clinton Foundation donor George Stephanopoulos? These guys should be filing at the Federal Election Commission as an in-kind contribution to the Clinton campaign. In all my years in politics, I've never seen anything more egregious or more outrageous. It's an attempt to dispirit Trump's supporters, and it follows on the heels of a number of false reports. Let's go through them. There is a staff mutiny at hand at the Trump campaign, 100% false. There's going to be an intervention by Trump's senior staff this weekend, 100% false. Campaign manager Paul Manafort has given up. He's now phoning it in. 100% false. Manafort, is of Sicilian extraction. He never quits. He's a fighter like Trump. So this is a smear writ large, Alex, and it is meant to particularly have a stifling effect on Trump's fundraising, which I'm sure that is happening, and to sow confusion within the ranks of Trump supporters. But to those folks who are listening or watching, Donald Trump is not dropping out of this race.
And let's be clear, Manafort is your business partner of 30-something years. We should probably get Manafort on here immediately or get him on other channels. But I'm sure he's been trying. I'm not seeing, you know, anywhere on the news Trump denying it other in his tweets and his statements. It looks like they're not even letting him get on air to say this is a lie.
Well, I think they're formulating a strategy. So I would sit tight, knowing Trump. I know he is not happy about this smear, but that's all it is. It's disinformation. This is something worthy of the Soviets. Look, we know, for example, that the DNC WikiLeaks absolutely, positively did not come from the Russians. We know that because Crucifer 2 took credit for them a good 2 weeks ago and initially released them. They got almost no attention. He then went to WikiLeaks. They re-released them. And, of course, they screwed up the entire first 2 days of the Democratic National Convention when it became clear that Debbie Wasserman Schultz had helped steal the nomination from Bernie Sanders for Hillary. So the Clinton campaign narrative that the Russians favor Donald Trump and the Russians are leaking this information, this is inoculation because, as you said earlier, they know what is coming and it is devastating. Let's remember that their defense in all of the Clinton Foundation scandals has been, not we didn't do it, has been, you have no proof. Yes, but you have no proof. Well, I think Julian Assange has that proof, and I think he's going to furnish it to the American people.
And let's point out that Assange is a real liberal, somebody that stands up for people's rights, for open societies. And I'm really proud of the fact that a lot of real liberals around the world are battling Hillary and pointing out how evil she is. But it's because they've got the hacked emails. There's no doubt that Trump's been hacked. There's no doubt people have dug into Trump. You know, I've had big hacker groups I know get into some of our stuff before, and they went, wow, we like you. We now know you're for real. That's how they check people out. And the truth is that Assange and all the groups that are feeding him, and the intel we've got from William Binney and others now, is that it's not mainly Russia. Russia's been involved some in ClimateGate and things, exposing that fraud, that it's people in U.S. intelligence that are actually leaking this to WikiLeaks.
Well, and say what you like about Assange, he is a true progressive. He's really a liberal. Hillary's not a liberal. She's a crony capitalist. She's about the money. This is a criminal enterprise, not an ideological enterprise. This is the point that Bernie Sanders was trying, not very well, to make. I have a major piece coming on Hillary's relationship with the big banks and why she has sold out to the big banks on both coasts, essentially doing their bidding and destroying the small community banks that most of us go to.
Sure. Just to be clear, Roger Stone, you're saying, obviously, this is all fake. Trump said that over and over again when they tried to beta test this a month ago or a month and a half ago back in June. But clearly, this is the panic we see is that they know more WikiLeaks is coming out. They know stuff's coming out about how ill Hillary is and things like that.
Yeah, so they have to try to disqualify Trump now through these smear tactics. I think that is precisely the strategy. And then I see reports today that Republican National Chairman Reince Priebus called Trump and lit into him. Let me tell you how unlikely that is. First of all, Reince Priebus is a historical figure. He's the only Republican national chairman in the history of the party since 1860 who has lost a presidential election and been kept on in that job. Generally speaking, losers are encouraged to move on, and perhaps Trump should have named a chair who is more loyal.
Absolutely. Clearly, he's there to throw elections. The fix is in. The Republican establishment's working with Hillary, all lined up denouncing Trump. This is the greatest endorsement of Trump ever to any true populist.
Well, and is there any voter anywhere who cares about whether Paul Ryan has endorsed Donald Trump or vice versa? I mean, Paul Ryan is an open borders man. He's a TPP man.
I am proud of the fact that Trump hasn't endorsed that TPP guy that stabbed him in the back.
Yeah, I totally agree. This again, though, the media continues to say, well, how will Trump possibly win without the support of the Bushes and the Romneys and the Ryans? The answer is easily, because those people are discredited.
A bunch of discredited globalist rhino neocon losers. Thank God the Bushes and everybody else are against them. Now, expanding on that, I want to just read the quote from Trump in June when Politico and the New York Times trial ballooned that he was being paid off to quit, which is asinine. He's lost hundreds of millions in boycotts alone. Why would he quit for $150 million? This story, this is Donald Trump, is a total fabrication from you and Politico, as usual. The New York billionaire said in an email sent by his campaign manager, I will never leave the race. Nobody has had enough money to pay me to leave the race. And if they did, it would be totally illegal anyways. Did Obama and the Clintons get you to write this? Now, this was said a few weeks before the emails came out that Politico directly is getting talking points, just like ABC News. And just like the New York Times. So I mean, Trump is shown to be prescient here, Roger.
Yeah, this is part and parcel of the mainstream media's bag of tricks. And of course, I think it was Winston Churchill who says, you know, the rumor's halfway across the room before the truth has a chance to put its pants on.
That's right.
This is precisely what's happening here. And it's runaway. It has become, you know, ubiquitous. You go on Twitter, you go on Facebook, you have all these people parroting the mainstream media regarding the fact that Trump is on the verge of dropping out, which, just to be clear, he absolutely, positively is not. Anyone who knows Trump knows that this will only spur him on to greater effort, that this will only make him hunker down and fight harder. You're right. We did face this exact same messaging from the media and the left during the nomination phase. I am beginning, Alex, as I know you are, to turn my attention to what I think is the real danger here once this particular thing is tamped down, and that is the very real possibility of election fraud, the very real possibility that this election will be stolen from Donald Trump.
And we're going to pause in a moment and talk about that. Look, it's not you advising Trump or even myself, though I know we both told him this and he concurs, that obviously if they try to steal the nomination, they're fixing everything. They won't list you on Google as a presidential candidate. They're censoring you everywhere. They're lying about you. They're going to try to steal it. Do what you did in the primaries. Point out the fraud so that politically we have the will as a public to say no, and they may back off, or we're going to challenge it. Well, obviously that's what Trump's doing, not because he listens to us, but because it's the truth and common sense, and that has panicked the White House. And as you know, hundreds of publications that know that you and I, the day before he went public last Sunday, challenged Trump to do exactly this. And it's not that they're scared that we're advising Trump. It's that they're scared that he is such a real patriot and has never compromised and is threatening to overturn their entire system.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. This is a topic we have to get into at some length.
I'm going to break here for just a moment and come back and get into that. If you can do 5 minutes the next hour, we'd love to have you. And if you can do a full hour tomorrow or do a special report, this is such a key time. Roger Stone is our guest. But before I break for a moment, I just want everybody to understand something. I cannot hype enough to you the situation we're in. There are not words how over the top, how epic, how insane all this is. And I'm going to ask Roger, as we get into election fraud, not just voter fraud, but institutional black box fraud, I want to ask him, is this jumping the shark? My gut tells me, my gut's never wrong, that if people grab their destiny in their hands, the fact that the whole system's panicking against Trump and escalating the lies to cartoon level, that this is going to backfire with people, especially because we have a few months, and that this is only going to embolden the public to support him in a landslide. I think this panic by the establishment is the most illustrative point that their time has come, that their time is over in the history of this republic. We're going back to Roger Stone of StoneZone.com in a moment. But first, the Clinton rape shirt is super aggressive, but the globalists are aggressive. Everyone needs to get the Clinton rape shirt at InfoWarsStore.com. And you need free shipping, by the way, this week. That's the special right now. And wear it and cause a debate and talk about it. It's the archetypal Obama hope style. Get out there, get aggressive. We're going to lose everything if we don't. They're trying to bully us into submission. Get the Hillary for prison shirt that has been in thousands of publications, that has absolutely forced that onto the floor of the RNC, that has sent fear into the New World Order, that Assange comes out and says she will be in jail next. A lot of people say, man, you're risking your life. Of course I am. This is destiny. I'm not on the bad guy team, folks. You wild horses, to quote the Rolling Stones, couldn't drag me away from this. This is epic battle for the Republic. It's happening now. Everybody shoots their mouth off and says, hey, who's going to get in the arena for us? Who's going to fight the New World Order? Trump's doing it. Pure Americana. 100% manly John Wayne, but John Wayne for real. Putting his life on the line, his name, his treasure, every lie heaped on him, every demonization heaped on him. It's almost Christ-like. I'm not comparing him to Christ, but I mean, the sins of the world heaped on his back, blame for everything, target of the whole world, his family, drug to the mud, and Trump's up there like a bulldozer running right through him like a locomotive. I am so proud that I got on this bandwagon as my gut told me to do it a year and a half ago. Now, get the Clinton rape shirt. We also are going to sell out of the nootropic. It won't be in for about 3-4 weeks, maybe longer, of Brain Force, $17.76, normally $29.95. It's 40%+ off right now. DNA Force is set to sell out very soon. Vitamineral Fusion during this special. We're free shipping on top of these specials and a lot of other specials as well. We had to end the sale where everything was on discount, but the best sellers are still on discount until they sell out. That's going to be a few days in the case of Brain Force. Maybe a week or so in the case of DNA Force. InfoWarsLife.com takes you right to the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsStore.com takes you to the big umbrella site. InfoWarsHealth.com takes you to not my nutraceuticals or supplements, but folks I trust, folks I really love, folks that have high-quality products, and that's the longevity line. When you purchase it there, you get big discounts. You can get free shipping when you sign up for AutoShip. Become a distributor, get big discounts. InfoWarsHealth.com, and a percentage of the proceeds, about 10%, goes to help fund this operation as well when you get beyond Tangy Tangerine or Pollen Burst or whatever the case may be. But whatever you do, we're the tip of the spear. We're taking action. We're exposing the hoax that they're saying Trump is going to drop out, or will he drop out. That's like saying Hillary to drop out and creating a fake New York Post headline. That is illustrative of the level of their deception. Roger Stone, going back to you, my friend, talk about election fraud. Talk about what we're facing. And the fact that Trump is calling him on it and saying he's going to challenge it.
Yeah, this is, of course, unheard of. In political circles, there seems to be some naive notion that computerized voting cannot be rigged, is never rigged. I was actually on a program in Cleveland with the Huffington Post with my longtime friend Howard Fineman, who I agree on with almost nothing. And a woman from Huffington Post actually said, as a flat statement, there's no evidence whatsoever that election fraud exists. What planet do these people live on? These are computers. We have both seen a powerful video about how the so-called Diebold machines can be rigged. One of the reasons I went to California is because those machines are in common use there. They are under control of the state Secretary of State, who actually holds a position in the Hillary Clinton campaign. Now, you remember during the 2000 recount, people went out of their minds because Katherine Harris, who was the Secretary of State in Florida, had endorsed and campaigned and had a position in the Bush campaign. So in other words, it's okay for the Clintons, but it's not okay for Republicans. Extraordinary. We're going to be laying out a very specific plan in the next couple weeks to combat what I believe will be an egregious and outrageous effort to steal the next election. If the polls show, as I think they will, that Trump is in a dogfight for the presidency of the United States.
By the way, we have former chief Diebold engineers and others that have testified to state and federal legislatures that they engage in fraud, were ordered to engage in fraud, and that major elections have been stolen. So to have this Clinton lackey say it doesn't exist, this is just madness.
Well, and let me say, it's existed and been done by both parties. But look, I have a long sentimental attachment to the Republican Party. I'm a former Young Republican National Chairman. I have worked for 9 Republican presidential candidates, actually 8, because I proudly supported Gary Johnson against Mitt Romney. And helped Governor Johnson get on the ballot in 48 states. But it has happened at the hands of both parties. You'll recall the famous incident in which Karl Rove melted down on Fox the night of the 2012 election when he kept insisting that the results shown on the screen couldn't possibly be right because Ohio was going for Romney. Why was he so sure? Why was he so positive he was right unless, of course, he thought the fix was in, which is exactly what he thought. So it is a topic for broader discussion, but more importantly, we are going to lay out in the next couple weeks a very specific, detailed plan on what the average citizen can do to fight voter fraud.
And I've also noticed that
election theft.
Hillary's chief of staff said this is, quote, dangerous what Trump's doing, pointing out fraud. They're really scared of us ahead of time pointing out she's crooked because everybody knows she's crooked. She's fixed everything. The primaries, everything. It makes perfect sense for Trump to come out and say that. So they're really scared of us. I think the fact that Trump came out this week and said, I'm going to fight election fraud, I think that helps send them into this panic.
Well, you have to let them know in advance that you're not going to stand for it, that if there's any solid evidence of election irregularity, you're prepared to challenge her swearing in and create a constitutional crisis. Now, in 1960, we had the closest election in American history. There was ample evidence that Richard Nixon had been robbed. But the truth is, the largest reason he didn't challenge those results is because they were irreversible. The reason they were irreversible was because ballots in the state of Texas had already been burned. There was nothing to recount. Lyndon Johnson destroyed the evidence. Texas was stolen from the Nixon Lodge ticket. Today, however, you have, at least on some of these machines...
Hold on, do five more minutes. This is key, but Texas put Kennedy in, Texas took Kennedy out. Back in 70 seconds, five more minutes with Roger Stone.
Thank you for listening to GCN.
We've got so much epic news today.
Visit GCN.
By the way, they're about to make you wear burkas at water parks. I'm not kidding. In the last 5 minutes, we have a Roger Stone, who we've got to get back on for a full hour tomorrow or Saturday or Sunday. There's just I'm working 7 days a week right now. There is so much going on. In fact, I will be doing a special report Saturday, so everybody knows, Saturday night. It'll be at InfoWars.com. Stations are welcome to play it. We're going to have it up on the satellite. I'm going into a seven-day-a-week system right now. Is Clint Eastwood a deus ex coming in for Trump and saying, you know, the political correctness hates him, we got to be with Trump? How exciting is that? And then separately, we've done research on the con guy. Our story's on DrudgeReport.com today. This con guy founded a super hardcore Muslim Brotherhood law association to promote Sharia law in the West, that and the writings specifically call for the execution of gays. Exclusive. Khazir Khan founded Islamic Journal to defend Sharia law. Khan defends Sharia law responsible for executions of gays, women in 11 countries. I mean, wow. And then he's hooked in with the Clintons. What is going on here, Roger?
Yeah, this is what they call a con job, if I may. The real irony, of course, is that he chastises Trump at the convention, asking him if he's ever read the Constitution. On the other hand, Mr. Khan is an advocate for Sharia law and has specifically written in numerous places that Sharia would take precedence over the U.S. Constitution. Now, Alex, I don't need to tell you the difference. Under Sharia, women and gays and Christians and others are oppressed, brutalized, and killed, whereas the U.S. Constitution protects all those people. So the fundamental basis of attack on Trump is phony. Go a next step, which is Trump's proposed ban for a temporary ban on Muslim immigration is not unconstitutional. It's perfectly legal. The president has that authority to block any group for any period of time. And
I say arrest Obama for not checking their passports.
The country don't have constitutional rights.
Exactly.
They're not U.S. citizens. So the whole thing is a canard, and more is being learned about Mr. Khan every day. Like I said, it's a con job.
How do we, in the last 2 minutes we have with you, 2.5 minutes, how do we strike back? Obviously, we're not losing. They're being forced to lie, go thermonuclear. That's going to backfire. But it makes me wonder. I mean, you say Trump's got big huevos. I agree. He is in danger. We should be praying for Donald Trump. But how do we counter just weaponized lies?
Yeah, look, I think the best way, of course, is to keep repeating the truth. But just watch Trump. He will handle this with aplomb. I think they're handing him an opportunity because they are so over the top. They're so overextended. This is so outrageous that I think there's going to be a backlash of sympathy for him. Just I would key off what Trump says, watch his tweets, watch his appearances. He was very effective in Daytona yesterday. It's outrageous to me. We can now learn that Hillary gave Apache helicopters to the ISIS, but we're busy talking about whether Trump is going to drop out, which he's not.
That's right. And boy, wait till the new WikiLeaks comes out. Assange, like you said earlier, he doesn't exaggerate. This must be devastating. And the word is, it is confirmed, her ordering weapons to Al-Qaeda.
Yeah, look, I think he's got a treasure trove of documents, and I expect that he will drop them at strategic times, the day before a debate, for example. Therefore, that's their greatest single danger. But at the same time, Trump has to be poised to exploit each one of those openings. He has to be poised to make sure that the mainstream media doesn't mute those things the way they have muted all the bad news.
And every single listener is so key in the fight, sharing articles, sharing links, sharing the grassroots response. We're bigger than the mainstream media when the listeners decide to move. But they've got to understand they're the power.
And Trump is bigger than the Republican Party. And this idea that the Republican National Committee is preparing for a plan for when Trump drops out, complete and total BS. Trump's not going anywhere other than the White House.
That's right. Roger, I'll talk to you tonight if you can talk. Thank you so much. Get some rest and hopefully get you back tomorrow. Thank you, sir.
Many thanks.
Wow. Roger Stone, StoneZone.com. Get the Clinton Rape shirt at InfoWars store and help fund this operation and spread the truth. We'll be back with another Patriot. Well, it was a few years ago that I came out and pointed out that Hillary Clinton is the founder of ISIS. That's just the new modern name of Al-Qaeda. Our own military came out within a week of Benghazi, Colonel Schaefer and others on the show, CIA whistleblowers like Tosh Plumlee, and said that Hillary was shipping weapons directly to Al-Qaeda. Then the public got upset about it. The military got upset, so they changed the name to ISIS. Same flag, same group. Al-Qaeda's state is Islamic State. Okay, that's their country, but it's all run by Saudi Arabia. And we can actually put on screen some of the YouTube videos and articles that we wrote and that we shot with the headline, Hillary Clinton is the founder of ISIS. Founder of ISIS, Hillary Clinton lectures America on terrorism. And you can scroll down. That's one of our little sub-channels. And you can see that's April 5th, 2016. But you can go back several years and find the clips. I'm not bragging. It's just great to see Donald Trump really understanding what we're dealing with. We've now seen Giuliani pick up that nomenclature at the RNC. And here's Donald Trump yesterday talking about how Hillary Rodham Clinton is the founder of ISIS.
Look at San Bernardino. Take a look at the World Trade Center. Take a look at what's going on. And then worldwide. And we let ISIS take this position. It was Hillary Clinton that she should get an award from them as the founder of ISIS. That's what it was. That's what it was.
What
her
it was.
Weakness. Her weak policies.
I've been waiting for this a long time. Oh, I love Trump. Nobody's got those waves. All right, continuing. So that's why they're now running around saying, they tried this in June. They said, oh, he's getting $150 million from the Koch brothers to drop out. He's lost hundreds of millions in TV contracts and stuff just by being boycotted. He's like, that's crazy. I'm all in. I'm never quitting. Little Bird told me that Trump will spend $1 billion of his own money in the last month of the campaign, if need be. He's raised 80-something million in the last month. He is dominating. And they got Reuters out doing 15% higher numbers of Democrats they poll than Republicans to say she's 10 points ahead. They admit it. Total fraud. And I've been all over the country. My crew's been all over the country, whether it's Philadelphia or Cleveland or whether it's Los Angeles or whether it's Miami or whether it's Dallas or whether it's Chicago. I mean, you see our crew every week, just all over the country. Leanne McAdoo in 3 days in L.A. couldn't find people on the street that supported Hillary. Now, granted, like 80% or so supported Sanders. The rest were Trump. She went to exit polls, finally found some. We have the video. 8 out of 10 were for Sanders. But we don't need to know they stole it. They admit the day before the superdelegates met at a, quote, rich person's house with the AP who runs the election announcements, and they decided what numbers to put on the news the next night over martinis. That was in the New York Daily News. We have entered the twilight zone here. And now they come out and say, Trump is going to give up. Trump is going to stand down. Trump is giving up his campaign. Trump puts out tweets and statements that he hasn't, about to give a speech. The media doesn't cover it. And they have Stephanopoulos, a Clinton operative, on ABC saying it's going to happen. That's why I ran images earlier in the last hour saying Hillary's going to resign tomorrow. Now, I said it's satire, but imagine if I really put this out and said I had sources, I would be drummed out, and I should be, of the media. But not the establishment media. Joining us is somebody who has a lot of courage as well, James O'Keefe. There's video that we posted last week, because our reporters caught it on tape. Bernie mob attacks Hillary fans. He was dressed up like a Hillary supporter. They attacked him. O'Keefe strikes again. Project Veritas exposes disunity of DNC. I'm going to get to that in a moment with James O'Keefe of ProjectVeritas.com. But I want to get his take on the number one news story. Isn't Hillary and Apache helicopters to Al-Qaeda or ISIS? It's not the fact that she looks like she's having mental meltdowns every day now. It's not any of this, James. It's not the latest Islamic attack that they're saying is an Islamic attack in London. Or the priest saying, you basically get behind me, Satan, before he's killed. And they attempt to cover that up with them changing the name Ali to David. No, it's all that Trump's quitting when none of it's true. None of it's even true. It seems like we're watching the mainstream media finally die in front of us. I think this signals desperation. Now, you're a smart, savvy guy. Do you disagree with me? We lost James's audio. James, hold on. We're not getting your audio through. I'm sorry. We've changed. Let's start over. Go ahead, James. Okay.
Thanks. Sorry about that, Alex. I think it's all manufactured. I think everything on television these days is manufactured. And after, Alex, I was at the DNC with some of your crew last week in Philadelphia, and I saw things that nobody else saw. I saw thousands and thousands of people angry. It was like the World War Z movie with Brad Pitt. They were climbing over each other to try to get over the fence, the perimeter fence that they created. So I turned on Fox, MSNBC, CNN. I didn't see that. I saw a gobbledygook speeches inside the convention.
They told us there was total unity, just loving.
No, there was no unity, and we don't see those images on television. So everyone you see, everything you see, they're paid consultants, paid to give their positions. You're not seeing the reality. And frankly, the media is obviously trying to create this narrative against Trump. We knew that they would do that. But on the ground, well, I talked to black protesters. I talked to Bernie people who are more angry and more hateful towards Hillary Clinton than any Republican or Trump supporter I know. I was thrown to the ground. As you're looking now, one of these guys attacked me, started screaming, "Hillary stole the election," is what he said. And many people were angry at me. I was dressed up like a Hillary supporter.
You have a lot of courage, buddy.
They were so angry, more angry than any Republican I've ever talked to.
I can't find Hillary supporters unless I go to the richest areas of Austin. Hillary really looks like she's degenerating. What do you think is really going on here?
I think that the media is trying to do their best to elect Hillary and create these large narratives that Trump is in trouble and so forth and so on. I do think people ask me, who do you think is going to win? I think it's a 50-50 chance because the Clintons are sort of diabolical, and I have evidence of voter fraud. But I think that people around the country are really upset. And the most powerful thing we exposed in Philadelphia, I don't know if you have this clip handy, were African-American protesters screaming at the top of their lungs, the Democrats have done nothing to help them in the inner cities. The actual quote was, have you seen the poverty in Philadelphia? Have you seen the homelessness? That's why we want to leave the Democratic Party. So I said undercover, and my colleague said, there he is right there. I don't know if you have the sound from that. But we said to him, what about the fact the first female president breaking the glass ceiling? He says, to hell with the glass ceiling. I'm trying to put food in the refrigerator. This is a very powerful clip. So people are angry. You don't see that on television. I don't know why you don't see it, but the corporate media won't report that, but we will.
We're queuing that clip up right now, but these are some of the viral videos that InfoWars shot with Project Veritas, and there's so many others where you do expose election fraud, all of it. I'm really heartened because they're being forced out in the open. They're being forced to steal primaries. They're being forced to try to steal the general election. They're lying and saying Trump's dropped out when he hasn't. I mean, they are engaged really in panic mode, I think. So I think down the road, time is running out for these people. I'm very confident.
Yeah, the whole media narrative you're seeing on television, where they're creating narratives that he's in trouble, he's going to drop out, and so it's all crap peddled by the political consulting marketing industry and paid consultants. It doesn't mean anything. And most people I've found, Alex, I don't know if your reporters have found the same thing in the country. People are so angry at the system, they don't even believe it anymore.
That's what I'm saying. And I think them getting even more arrogant and more deceptive is going to backfire because, look, people know she stole this from Bernie, and they know they're trying to steal it now. And Trump is saying that, and they seem to be in total panic mode. Let's play the clip that Mr. Veritas was talking about. Here it is. There you go. I don't care about a glass ceiling. I care about food. What about the woman in my life?
That's right. And Alex, I mean, the power of that clip, if that was said by a Republican or someone protesting a Republican, that'd be played on every single television station over and over and over again to create a narrative. And one thing Andrew Breitbart taught me is it's all about the media. It's all about the narratives. And that flies in the face of every single narrative that's out there. He said, that same man, who's actually part of the Bernie movement, he said that young black men are leaving the Democratic Party, and Hillary depends on those folks to win. And he said, we will never vote for her. And if there was any justice in the media, they'd be playing footage like that. And they'd have a narrative on the front page of the New York Times that is Hillary losing black supporters? So that's we're right. Bringing this footage to you. You guys were with us in Philadelphia. Your cameraman was next to me as I was thrown to the ground filming it. So they're not going to report this, but Alex, that clip was viewed a million times on Facebook, millions of views on YouTube. So we're doing our job to get the message
absolutely
out.
Absolutely. CNN average show has 200,000 viewers, MSNBC a couple hundred thousand. So they can have big fancy $50 million sets. It doesn't matter because we actually have the audience. So we've reached that paradox moment where they're lying, they're doubling down, they're totally going Soviet style and beyond. But the Soviets could get away with it for a while because there was no counterbalance. Don't they understand there's a major counterbalance, James O'Keefe?
Yeah, they understand it, which is why that they're throwing everything on television constantly over and over again. Trump's in trouble, Trump's in trouble, Trump's in trouble, because they have to create this corporate echo chamber on all the big TV stations to counteract the popularity of the grassroots. So you're literally seeing right now things... The powers dynamics are shifting. I wrote about this when the shootings happened and people were filming it. The power dynamics are changing and it's making them very upset. And if there's one thing I learned from being in Philadelphia at the DNC is the sheer shock of seeing the thousands of protesters piled like zombies trying to get over the fence and looking at the TV screens inside of those lobbies in the hotels thinking, that's not what I'm seeing outside. So There's a power shift happening. I've been around long enough for 7 years doing this to know that everything I see on TV, I mean, it's all just gobbledygook identity politics crap. And we have to get the images in front of people, make them trend on social media or on your website. That's the only way that we're gonna because
exactly. And it's not like we're cherry picking quote minorities for Trump or minorities against Hillary. That's all we see at rallies I have or events. That's all we see. And then we tune in CNN. It's like a whole nother planet where they've got 20 reporters out cherry picking to, you know, put together this lie. But what do they do when almost everyone I talk to, quite frankly, I think Sanders was as popular as Trump, which is, you know, I mean, wrong message, but he was right about some of the problems, a lot better than Hillary. But so, I mean, Sanders is popular. Trump's popular. I'm not finding the Hillary people. Like I said, I mean, I don't know what her real numbers are. But no wonder Reuters has to oversample Democrats in polls. And I mean, because they're trying to prop the facade up. It's so incredible. In fact,
when we walked through the protest, the video you played a week ago, that this was a California Hillary delegate saying we need to ban all guns, but call it common sense gun legislation. This is a direct quote. She said, if you just say S-H-I-T like that, people will buy into it. That is what Mary Bayer said. So I walked through the Bernie crowd, Alex. with that little video you're watching, a placard of her face and her quote, I got high fives from the Bernie people.
Which shows they're watching your show, they're watching mine, which shows we are unifying the people just under common sense.
Yes, that's exactly right. People agree on 80% of the issues. This identity politics gobbledygook is all just a ploy to divide the people. Bernie people were friendly to the idea of someone lying and saying they want to ban all guns. They were friendly. All the protesters, no one was negative to me when I was.
And by the way, the Sanders people are well spoken compared to Hillary supporters.
Yes, and they were all very supportive. They said, we need to expose the fraud and the lies and the deceit and the black people being taken advantage of in the inner cities. And they're trying to ban guns and call it something else. It's when I dressed up like a Hillary supporter and walked through there, and they threw me to the ground and screamed in my face, you stole the election. So we are more united than we think. Those people don't have a voice on television, but they have a voice with people like you and people like Veritas and YouTube and Facebook, as long as Facebook doesn't censor people like they did Milo Yiannopoulos, but we're looking into that too.
Well, in the time we've got left here, talking about Matt Drudge, you know, Drudge came here almost, it was like 10, 11 months ago, and he said, look, he said, I got approached, Supreme Court justice. They said next year they're going after the free speech. We now see it happening in Europe, happening here. But I think it's going to only make people value free speech even more. But clearly, if they can try to boycott and bring down Limbaugh, which they failed, I thought Limbaugh's perfect. I'm not either. But folks, they get Limbaugh, they get everybody else. If they can shut down Drudge with Federal Elections Commission garbage, which I know they've been calling for, if they and they've said, Media Matters has said, go after me too. They've tried to put you in prison. I mean, the point is there really is a war on the press, and anybody who really is for free speech in America better come together because the establishment's making their move.
Matt Drudge is a hero of mine. I love the interview he did with you, and what an honor he did it with you and nobody else.
Absolutely. That's a big honor.
Huge honor. I'll say this. Veritas is breaking lots of local stories because I think the local politics is where you can make the most change, and that's what we're doing. In the last 24 hours, we exposed voter fraud in Michigan. And instead of relying upon the mainstream press to get a comment from the mayor of Detroit, which is what I usually would do, I went to the mayor's office with a film crew. And the mayor's lawyer said, where's your press credentials? And my response was, the First Amendment is my press credentials. It doesn't draw any distinction between citizen journalists and the corporate press. And the fact that you asked me for press credentials is the reason why we have this incestuous crap in the
media. And that video is at ProjectVeritas.com. It's very powerful. Let's talk about this.
Yeah, this guy you're looking at right now, this is the mayor of Detroit. This is his legal counselor, Butch Hollowell is his name. He's the chief lawyer for the city of Detroit. He threatened me. And in this video, later in the video, you can hear him saying you're an accomplice to a crime and anybody who publishes your videos is an accomplice to the crime. I said, is that NBC News an accomplice to the crime? Is Alex Jones an accomplice to the crime? I mean, these people are so conceited that they would try to come after me for doing journalism. I said, where's your press credentials? So what's the solution, Alex? The solution is to record him saying that, is to expose the mentality.
To call his bluff.
Call his bluff, put the video out there of what he's saying, and now he's backtracking. He's been on local media all day. You're not going to see these stories on CNN. You're going to see them on YouTube. You're going to hear me talk about it with you. But little by little, what we're doing is we're calling their bluff, holding them accountable for their crap so that they're on defense. That's what we have to do.
Absolutely. You know, I think our greatest asset is the fact that they're so arrogant. I mean, I wonder why. I mean, the more, quote, influence I have, the more concerned I get that I be absolutely accurate and do a good job. With more power comes great responsibility. I think of myself 20 years ago, my gosh, you know, 10 years ago. But I look at these people, the more power they get, the more arrogant they get. And I think that's their greatest weakness.
It is their, you're absolutely right. You have a great power in your medium, as do I, and a lot of responsibility we have to, because I get hundreds of people a week say, James, you got to come to Wichita, Kansas and look at this issue. There's no voice for them. But like you said, it's jujitsu. If this guy, for example, the mayor of Detroit, wants to threaten me with criminal charges for filming a city clerk, then my responsibility now is to tell that part of the story to the American people. And he gets defensive and says, oh, I didn't mean that. I didn't mean that. The people have a right to do journalism. So it's our job to hold them accountable. We just need more people doing this. And that's what will happen. And
absolutely. We're not trying to make them gonzo journalism. They're making themselves the story, acting like thugs.
That's exactly right. They're making us do this. until they stop acting like thugs. I'll be honest, he's a fascist pig. The fact that he threatened me and threatened anybody in the media to criminalize, you know, asking a clerk a question and filming it, it was a disgrace. And I sat there and I was worried I wasn't getting out of his office yesterday. He said, "Where's your credentials?" And they're, "My cameraman's outside." He said, "Well, you better lawyer up." And I thought he was going to have me arrested.
Oh, as if you've got, again, the press is that you've got a venue, you're the people, you're asking questions, period. The First Amendment is it. Well, James O'Keefe, ProjectVeritas.com. I just love seeing how you're getting even more prolific. You've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of auxiliary folks and volunteers around the country. You've got a book that breaks down how to do this. People can contact you. And you have written the blueprint on how to successfully counter these people. And I think it will be information warfare that you're involved in that will bring down the New World Order.
Yes, and we're going to keep growing. And thanks, Alex, for putting the videos out. And kudos to your team. I met them. They're phenomenal. You've got great people working for you. So your audience knows they're professional, they're gracious, and they did a phenomenal job getting
all. Thank you. Well, they were honored to work by, you know, beside you, because you're one of their rock stars. We got a minute and a half left. What other tidbits would you like to put out to folks? What do you think the next shoe to drop is?
The next shoe from our camp is we have people embedded at the highest levels of the people committing any types of fraud in the country. My focus for the election is people saying something in public and saying something else in private. So anybody running for elected office, not just for president, but for Senate, for governor, we have you on hidden camera saying to your donors and to the American people, saying in private that you disagree with what you say publicly. We're going to release those tapes. We also have videos, as I've hinted at before, voter fraud at the highest levels, but we got to hold on to it, because if I release it right now, it's going to burn our undercover citizen journalists. So we're going to go deeper and deeper, and we're going to expose the extent to which Hillary's folks are going to steal the election, lie, and so forth.
Gee, I love that. You've got moles that are patriots in there. We're getting deeper and deeper, and we've got so many great people, even in government, as you know, that are also doing their duty and getting us the intel of what's happening. Boy, I tell you, the tyrants better be watching it.
They are going to be scared. They are afraid, as evidenced in the recording today from Detroit. You can see the fear. You can smell the fear. My job is to film the fear and make them internet celebrities.
Well, they've awakened the sleeping giant. James O'Keefe, ProjectVeritas.com. We salute you. Thank you so much, sir, for all the explosive.
Thank you.
All right, speaking of explosives, it's up on drudgereport.com right now. Investigative journalist Wayne Madsen on The Real Khan. Khazir Khan founded Islamic Journal to defend Sharia law. Khan defends Sharia law responsible for execution of gays and women, if they talk back, in 11 countries. This guy is a real piece of work. And this link to the article is up on Infowars.com. It's a Wayne Madsen article. We're going to be talking to him in a moment. This is a big deal. But first, Trump hasn't given a speech yet to fully respond to them saying he's dropping out of the race and that he's giving up. Now, back in June, he told Politico, "You're liars. It's totally made up. Stop it." Now they've launched it as the biggest story out there, that he would be dropping out. He would be giving up. And then they said, "Oh, what happens if he does?" And then they said his whole campaign's against him. His kids hate him. In fact, he blew up the Lusitania. He crucified Christ. These are acts of desperation. But it makes me think, what are they going to do next? But Josh Owens actually got a clip of Trump yesterday beginning to talk about this, saying we've never been more unified. Here it is.
So I just want to tell you, the campaign is doing really well. It's never been so well united. We started on June 16th. I would say right now it's the best in terms of being united that it's been since we began. We're doing incredibly well. We're leading in the state of Florida. You saw the poll. We're leading in Ohio. We have a president that doesn't know what the hell is going on. And I don't think he likes me too much. You have Bernie Sanders. People are going to be voting for Trump. Something just came in. They like Trump. When we run, we have to make sure that you don't have people voting 10 times. Because, as you know, there's a big difference now from what there was before. Oh, there he is. All right, you can get him out. You know what that is? That's the final remnant of Bernie's protesters. That's it. Final.
Which it turns out Roger Stone was correct. In Chicago, those were people from Clinton's campaign dressed up as Sanders supporters to create a wedge against her two enemies. Her primary challenger, who was really winning, Sanders, and then Trump in the general election. We're going to Wayne Madsen and WayneMadsenReport.com here in a moment. We are running a special of free shipping this week on three of our best-selling items, Brain Force, DNA Force, and Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch Drink. Great way to get your kids to take all their vitamins and minerals and amino acids and cofactors with the Vitamin Mineral Fusion. But Brain Force at $17.76, similar formulas that aren't even as good, are $50, $60, $70. It's a great deal at $29.95. Well, we've got it basically as a loss leader at $17.76. Experience Brain Force. It's got actual building blocks of the brain in it. Several ingredients are controlled or prescription in Europe. 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139 to call or ask any questions. That will sell out in the next 24 hours. So we're going to have to pull that part of the special. But what I'm going to do is add something else in there so that throughout the week, throughout the weekend, we have three things that are discounted and free shipping on top of that. And if you sign up for AutoShip, you get 10% additional off on things that you obviously reorder, like non-GMO, High Mountain, Mexican, organic, volcanic coffee, Wake Up America coffee, or whether it's a nootropic or Supermel Vitality or X2, the good halogen. And your purchases obviously fund this operation. So I want to thank you all for your support. There's some other specials as well, but we had to end the special where everything was, you know, discounted, but there wasn't free shipping. Now there's free shipping specifically on those. But regardless, whether it's a gravity-fed water filtration system or Hillary for prison shirt, it's all about getting the word out or having a high-quality product or a supplement that's great for you and your family. And where can you deny there's an organization that's having a bigger effect against the New World Order? I mean, I'm not bragging, but I coined the term that Hillary Clinton was the founder of ISIS years ago. Now Trump says it. And I said, hey, we need you immediately to come out and talk about election fraud and fight this. And I'm not going to get into inside of baseball, but Trump was already on it. So you saw what happened. And now Trump's doubling down on all this. He's not backing off. And that's why they've got the establishment media in total and complete panic mode. Now, investigative journalist Wayne Madsen, author as well, best-selling author, formerly with Naval Anti-Submarine Warfare before he was then in the National Security Agency before rising to one of the heads of the major internal security operations. I want to get his take first on William Binney. It was almost last week, but another interview on, I think, WABC in New York with Aaron Klein. And saying, look, the NSA already has all the metadata, all the tracking. They know the IP addresses. They already have her emails. Binney is on tomorrow also live with us to elaborate on this. What does he think WikiLeaks is getting ready to release? The word is it's going to be the fact that Hillary was directing with the Turkish ambassador, what we already knew from our military sources, the weapons to Al-Qaeda, that she had the name changed to ISIS to confuse the public. But then that ties into our next story. Exclusive, Khazir Khan founded Islamic Journal to defend Sharia law. This is on drudgereport.com. Khan defends Sharia law responsible for executions of gays and women in 11 countries. You say, gays for what? Just being gay. Women talking back. Or if men rape you, they can then execute you. This is fruitcake land. And then, of course, he didn't attack Gold Star families or people that have died in war. He said, why is this woman on TV not talking? That's a real statement. This guy's a Sharia law expert who founded a journal to promote it in the West. But CNN says he's not, so we're going to cover the waterfront. That dovetails with this article on Infowars.com. France, water park to hold Burkini Day, close quote, non-Muslim swimming attire banned. So it's on, folks, and those are not Teletubbies you see on screen. Look, I'm a real liberal, okay, classical liberal. I get offended by this. The bullying, you know, the latest stabbing attack, Allah Akbar, the Islamic mayor saying, you know, deal with it. Wayne Madsen, thank you for joining us. I kind of set the table there with a bunch of different points. So where do you want to start?
Well, I mean, I listened to Mr. Khan's speech in Philadelphia, And I have to say, it did initially pull at everybody's heartstrings. You could have heard a pin drop, obviously, during his speech. But like everything that they parade out, every individual you've never heard before, there's always a backstory. And of course, with Kaiser Khan, there's a backstory. And the fact is, he's a co-founder of an academic journal that was basically trying to sell Sharia law in systems that practice Western jurisprudence based on Roman law and English common law. And frankly, there is no place for Sharia law in Western legal systems. It's a practice that comes out of the 11th century. And for anyone to advance the idea that Western jurisprudence can coexist with Sharia law is really out there where the buses don't run.
Well, let's talk about this journal. Let's get into your detailed report.
Yeah. He co-founded this journal. The other co-founder was an individual who ran an Islamic law center in Geneva, Switzerland, who has been tied to the Muslim Brotherhood. Now, this, again, is very suspicious because we know that Hillary Clinton's close aide, Huma Abedin, her mother, who teaches a college at an all-women's college, by the way, in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. I haven't heard Hillary Clinton complain about that sort of sexism. This individual who was co-founded the journal with Kaiser Khan, member of the Muslim Brotherhood, and Huma Abedin's mother has been accused of having links to the Muslim Brotherhood. So what is with all these Muslim Brotherhood connections to the Hillary Clinton campaign? Obviously, the campaign found Kaiser Khan somehow. I also pointed out that his law office in New York is next door to the Waldorf Astoria Hotel. And on the top of that hotel is found the residence of the U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Samantha Power, who was also married to Cass Sunstein, Obama's former information czar, and the guy that said you defeat your enemies by practicing cognitive dissonance. And it looks like the Kaiser Khan episode is nothing more than an operation in cognitive dissonance as perfected by Cass Sunstein.
Well, I know people have dug into his journals, but specifically, I mean, he's promoting strict adherence to Sharia, which under that, if you're found to be homosexual, they murder you.
Oh, everything. And if you're a Muslim who converts to another religion, not just Christianity, say Buddhism or Scientology or anything, the penalty is death. So how can a legal system like that exist, coexist in Western systems? It's not possible. And for Khan to suggest it can, he's being academically dishonest.
Of course, he's being disingenuous to the max. Well, obviously, he's brought here in the 80s. He's a perfect cutout. He's hooked in with all these other groups that supply legal help to overstay visas. I mean, this guy is just classic, in my view, he has all the signs of being one of these worldwide Islamist operatives.
Yeah, and the other thing is, he's a member of the New York Bar, which would explain him having an office in New York City, although he lives in Charlottesville, Virginia, with his wife. Now, Charlottesville is a sanctuary city. It's the home of the University of Virginia, but he's not a member of the Virginia Bar. And when I suggested that he may be providing legal assistance to students at UVA who overstay their student visas and want to become permanent residents by gaming the system, I would note that apparently right after I put this report out, the website for his law firm was taken down. So who knows why that decision was made, but it may be that there was information on there telling people who are illegally in the United States.
We better go to the Wayback Machine right now.
Yeah, H-1B visa holders and student visa holders, how to game the system. I would also note that Virginia, seven of the hijackers on 9/11 had Virginia driver's licenses. So Virginia is a hotbed for this kind of gaming of the U.S. immigration system.
Well, we're all very sad for his son, but again, we wouldn't have all these Islamists here and all these cutouts We wouldn't have had 9/11 to begin with. We wouldn't have been in Iraq. That Saudi Arabia directed our government to attack the country that wasn't involved. I mean, this is so clear. This was done for Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia stood to gain from all of this. And you had the Bushes meeting that morning of 9/11 at the Carlyle Group function, The Guardian reported, there in D.C. at the Bin Laden family table.
Right. I would also point out something else about Captain Humayun Khan. His son was killed in combat in Baquba, Iraq in 2004. Present at his funeral at Arlington National Cemetery was a Mohammed Sadegh, who was the deputy chief of mission of the Pakistani embassy in D.C. Now, capitals like D.C., London, Moscow, Paris, Berlin, Tokyo, normally the DCM is the head of intelligence. In this case, that would have been Pakistan's ISI. And because ISI was basically founded by the CIA, they would follow the CIA's traditions of the DCM in those capitals being an intelligence official, the chief of station. What in the world was the head of ISI intelligence doing at Captain Humayun Khan's funeral at Arlington? Later, he surfaces in back in Islamabad in 2008, justifying are basically defending the ISI against charges from India that the ISI participated in the bombing of the Indian embassy in Kabul, Afghanistan. Very dodgy links here. Pakistan was not a member of the coalition in Iraq. So what in the world was Captain Humayun Khan?
This is a very shady grouping. It needs to be investigated. Shifting gears, Wayne, as a journalist, looking at the media, just keep saying, the word is Trump's going to resign. Trump goes, no, I'm not. Yeah, you are. This is just what we saw with Ben Carson in Iowa when he gets on an airplane, flies out at 5:30 in the afternoon. He's in second place. They announce, Ted Cruz does, that, you know, he's stepping down. He's resigning. You know, good luck, Ben Carson. That was a big scandal that they pulled that dirty trick. This is a giant dirty trick saying that Trump's going to be out of the race.
These are straw men that they float. They hope. Remember Karl Rove's whole idea of how to run a campaign. You throw it against the wall, even though it's untrue, but you see what sticks. And that's the game they're playing here. We know that Karl Rove is providing a backdoor consultation to Hillary Clinton's campaign. This is vintage Karl Rove, floating these red herrings, these trial balloons, these straw men.
I agree. And isn't that the word that was probably Rove also advising Cruz with that whole Carson stunt?
Oh, absolutely. Rove, you know, Rove, we know he still has his operation out of Austin, Texas, where you're at, but he also is involved in many of these campaigns behind the scenes. And I think when Trump recently worried about the election being rigged, he knows what happened, what Rove did in 2000, and especially in 2004 in Ohio. It's not just people voting more than once, 10 times.
That's right. Ohio was certified to be a fraud. This is bipartisan.
Absolutely. It's who counts the votes. Remember what Stalin said? It doesn't matter who votes. But he said what really matters is who counts the votes.
But it's historic. Correct me if you disagree, but most experts agree, in fact, all of them, that a landslide's hard to beat, and that if Trump makes a big issue about it, it puts sunshine on it. And that's why I think Hillary's campaign chief said, quote, what Trump's doing is dangerous.
Right. You know, whether Trump wins or loses, the mere fact he talked about rigged elections, which has always been a bête noire of Washington, they don't want to talk about it because both parties have people in office as a result of election fraud. He's raised that issue. And whether he wins or loses, I think that issue is going to be around. And that's what the people don't like.
Sure.
The upper echelon.
Doesn't that just add to his bona fides that he's bringing up issues like this?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's like with he's done more to advance the old story about JFK's assassination than anybody has in the past, say, 25 to 30 years.
Yeah, no, Trump's a godsend. I mean, everything he's done is expose the establishment. Everything he's done is expose globalism. Everything he's done has been an absolute godsend. That's why they hate him.
Right. That's correct. And I think, like I say, he's provided a good service, at least in bringing issues to the fore.
Yeah, folks know in the last year and a half, I've been kind of, you know, supporting Trump, but, you know, watching closely. But I got to say now, I'm 100% in. This guy's 100% for real. Now, it doesn't mean he's perfect. None of us are. But this guy is Americana. He doesn't like seeing America be destroyed. He's committed his life to it. We better get behind him. Wayne Madsen, stay there, my friend. DrudgeReport.com is linked to our story. We're going to keep putting these out with more intel and a bunch of highly produced video reports coming up soon that are basically like ads. Ads for free speech, ads for the First Amendment, not even for the election, that just show the election fraud, the history of it, how it works, what Hillary's done, and how to counter it, and then also show how they're lying about Donald Trump. But here's the story. It's up on Infowars.com deals with all of that, one we were showing during the last segment, if we can, guys, so that people can go there. Desperate mainstream media pushes Trump dropping out. Conspiracy theory. Dishonest media clicking its heel three times to make Trump go away. And then we've also are going to post some of the video reports in there that deal with this. But this is just like the Ben Carson situation where they just announced he's given up. But back then it was a big deal. This is the whole media doing it, not just Cruz. So they kind of all commit the crime against free speech, the crime against truth, and then just hope that no one group gets the blame. This is in unison talking points as the WikiLeaks show directly from Hillary Clinton. I mean, talk about dishonor. I am shocked that even mainstream media is this unified in dirtbaggery. Speaking of that, I want to get Wayne Madsen's take on it as he counters these folks. But here, speaking of dirtbags, here is Obama saying yesterday that, listen, if you're anti-government, how about anti-corrupt government? Get out of here. You didn't build the country. You didn't save General Motors and all this stuff, which was another scam. Here it is.
And you know, I always tell people who are anti-government here in the United States, try going to a country where the government doesn't work. And you'll see that you actually want a good government. It's a useful thing to have. But it's not enough on its own if you also don't have then the ability of people in the private sector to...
Like the economic collapse of Venezuela is so bad that people are slaughtering and eating zoo animals? That's up on Infowars.com from Michael Snyder. This implication that government made all this instead of innovation and lower taxes, Wayne, it's really getting crazy. You want to tackle that first or the earlier point I was making?
Well, I think the media is being absolutely horrible in covering Trump by pushing forth. They're the one, first ones that start talking about conspiracy theories and how terrible they are. And then they are pushing a conspiracy theory. Now, there was a story out of New York yesterday that's gotten no play on the national media. Apparently, a retired law enforcement officer was arrested trying to sneak into Trump Tower just before Trump returned from a campaign tour in Florida. He had a weapon on him. And basically, the New York Daily News, which hates Trump, said, oh, it was no big thing. The guy was drunk. Where is the mainstream on issues like that? Clearly, a lot of people feel that with the enemies he's creating, Trump may be in some sort of physical danger.
Oh, that's my next question. We know they're coming after him physically now. I mean, the panic level we're seeing.
Right. I mean, and look, you know, Jeb Bush, he feels like this thing was taken from him like, you take candy from a baby. You know, he was supposed to be the third Bush, and we know what the Bushes anyway are capable of. Now, there was one report that the person arrested at a Trump Tower was using the fake identity of an FBI agent who was killed in the line of duty in 2007 in a bank robbery situation.
Wow.
In central New Jersey. And his last name, ironically, Bush.
Oh, my gosh. Just like John Hinckley Jr. What do you think of him being released after 35 years for supposedly shooting Reagan? Is that a message?
Yeah, just in time for the campaign. I remember when Arthur Herman Bremer, I believe, was released during the 2012 campaign. And I said, oh, yeah, the guy who shot George Wallace during a campaign in 72 is now running free. So, you know, I guess that's what happens. They release.
I think they release him right in the thick of every big campaign's little message. Hey, we got these guys back in 70 seconds with the third hour. I want to ask you then, what do you expect him to throw at Trump next? Wayne Madsen's our guest. WayneMadsenReport.com, Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. Stay with us.
This is GCN, the Genesis Communications.
By the way, free
Radio
shipping
Network.
Right now on everything at InfoWarsStore.com. Wayne Madsen's our guest for another 5 minutes. Then, I should have plugged this earlier, this guy's a wild man, a superstar. The founder of Vice, till they went sideways, Gavin McGinnis, CompoundMedia.com. He's going to be joining us to talk about all this. We'll take phone calls. I got a special report Paul Watson did on Hillary really acting like she's a mental patient. And again, folks, you know, I don't just hype something because it sounds like something fun to hype. There's always enough real stuff to go with. Hillary's acting so freakazoid just when I normally see her. She's either all enraged looking or she looks like she's on drugs. And then she does these weird things where she just goes, and people are like, are you okay? Or like the balloon, she's like a little baby going, you're a smart guy, Wayne Madsen. What do you think's going on with Hillary?
Well, look, we still don't know what happened when she had that episode with a brain issue, apparently as a result of a fall when she was Secretary of State. Even her husband said it was more, Bill Clinton said it was more serious than what had been reported. So, again, usually medical issues are off limits during campaigns. But as we know from the 72 campaign, when McGovern had to drop Senator Tom Eagleton off the ticket as vice president, yes, medical issues are a very cogent issue during a presidential campaign because whether it's president or vice president, this is the person that's going to be in charge of the country or potentially in charge of the country, and their medical condition should be at issue. And
well, sure, but I mean, yeah. Normal people don't start doing these weird tics. I mean, this is stuff I see like homeless folks that are schizophrenic on the side of the road.
Yeah, and even after that episode, Hillary was wearing some special glasses, which are for people who have trouble keeping their balance after some sort of episodic event dealing with the brain. So
you're leaning towards stroke.
I would say stroke or an aneurysm that they caught before it was fatal. But there's obviously, and it could be, as you suggest, prescription medication she's on. I think there should be questions asked about her physical condition.
What about Bill Clinton? I mean, when I say he looks like a corpse, when I say he looks like a zombo, I mean, he could be in a movie as a zombie now.
Well, you know, he's had heart surgery, too. And you know, we know he was a major user of cocaine in his younger days. And I think all that catches up with you after a while. Look at some of these aging rock stars. And they can't even pronounce two words together later on in life.
Well, sure, the word is he's on coke until just a few years ago.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And look, we're not just picking on Democrats. We know that George W. Bush had an affectation for the white powder as well. And the
Nixon booze. Took a lot of pills.
Yeah, Nixon was a drunkard and a pill popper, especially towards the end. But you know, it's fair game for anyone, Republican or Democrat. Their medical, of course, the media is not touching it because
sure. We got 1 minute left, Wayne Madsen. What else do you expect them to go after Trump with? Because it's gotten crazy.
I think his wife is the one they're going after now, Melania. There's suggestions being floated that she was working in the United States illegally when she was a model, and now there's some suggestions, and this bears all the markings of a Karl Rove that she. Was some sort of an escort at one time. None of this, of course, is provable, but remember the Rove paradigm. It doesn't matter if it's true or not. Throw it against the wall and see what's
well, plus, it's all off limits because Trump doesn't make a big issue out of all that stuff.
Right. You know, and I mean, we know everything there is to know about Trump's personal life. He used to be on the cover of People magazine in the 1980s, ad nauseum, ad infinitum. It was always a Trump story. Studio 54, whatever it was, you know. So there's not much more there.
Absolutely. Well, she's a beautiful woman. And I guess that's her only crime with these a lot of these so-called feminists who just really want to run women's lives and boss women around and are really a cretinous group of people. Wayne Madsen, thank you so much. We'll talk to you again soon.
You bet, Alex.
Gavin McGinnis, straight up. It's Renaissance culture versus conquest culture. And in every system and in every time in history, there's been a mix of those two. But North Korea is a pure conquest slave culture. You could call maybe the Netherlands 100 years ago, you know, a pure innovation culture. And it's innovation that creates high culture, incredible true diversity, and incredible choices. And everything the so-called liberals are doing is about destroying those choices And that's why I can't stand them. I mean, because they're not just totalitarians. They claim they built all this renaissance. Like Obama, I played the clip last hour. We're going to play it coming up. He is running around right now saying that he and the government built our prosperity. I've got the full quotes here in an article. It's a shorter clip. He said, you know, if you like roads, you like General Motors, you like business, you like jobs, it's the government. That's the craziest thing historically. It is individual systems and ideas and large populations that produce civilization. I mean, I love Bill Maher bitching. I play the clip where he goes, I want more death. I want more abortion. I want more murder. Whatever gets the freeway moving. Hey, Dumbo, there's a big freeway in a mega city because there's 15 million people in Los Angeles and the greater area. And yeah, you swim into a coral reef and there's like 10,000 fish. You're like, oh, there's too many fish. You might go 10 miles before you see more fish. It's the same thing. You see all these people, that's the opportunity. If you don't like people, go to the countryside. Believe me, sometimes I want to. But don't say there's too many of them. Kill them so I can get on the freeway. There won't be a freeway, Dumbo. The truth is these are very unhappy people. And that's why they're out to get society. And you look at how hateful Hillary Clinton is. She's a great example. Gavin McGinnis' train had a problem. So he's going to be with us in about 10 minutes or so. Let's go to this Paul Joseph Watson report. Dealing with Hillary Clinton. It's up on Infowars.com. And we'll also put that article up on screen so TV viewers can actually get the URL. Because this needs to go extremely, extremely viral. It deals with Hillary Clinton and her medical condition. Experts, Hillary is a sociopath and could have brain damage. I think she looks like she has a rubber mask on and is about to pull it off. I mean, she looks like the woman that basically goes into the White House in Mars Attacks and pulls the mask off and she's a big green alien. Now, I'm not saying she's actually a green alien. I'm saying she looks like a cross between the Joker and the Wicked Witch of the West. I want to know where the flying monkeys are. Guess that's her assistant or whatever, Uma Abedin or Bill Clinton's like a flying monkey. But there's got to be some end to this. So if you're a radio listener, it's Paul narrating. If you're a TV viewer on stations here and there around the country or at Infowars.com/show, this video should be seen by everybody because she looks and acts like a total whack job. If I was interviewing somebody for a job and they were doing stuff like this, I would ask them, if they needed a drink of water before they left, because I wouldn't be wanting to be around someone who's obviously psychotic. I mean, she looks like, again, a person that you see on the side of the road who's a full-blown schizophrenic. But if I had to analyze her from psychological studies, I'd say she's a hardcore borderline personality disorder, leaning into full psychosis on a bunch of different fronts, and who routinely has psychotic breaks. She doesn't give tips. You can't look her in the eyes. She treats the Secret Service like dog crap. She yells and screams at other protective details. It's all on record that she is a lunatic. Here's the special report.
What on earth could be the reason behind Hillary Clinton's bizarre behavior in recent weeks? Weird seizures, psychotic facial tics, over-exaggerated reactions, coughing fits, strange lesions on her tongue. Is Hillary on the verge of a mental breakdown due to stress, or are her strange outbursts linked to a medical condition? Is Clinton suffering from actual brain damage, or are these odd manifestations just an expression of some kind of narcissistic personality disorder? I talked privately with psychologists and psychiatrists to try and answer this question, and here's what they told me. We know Hillary fainted and hit her head back in 2012, leading to a blood clot in her brain. In almost half of sufferers, this leads to side effects and neurological issues. According to neurologist Dr. Daniel Casiche, Hillary has post-concussion syndrome and cannot tolerate stress-inducing environments. Experts told me that this footage likely shows Hillary having a mild Jacksonian type of seizure caused by a side effect of the blood clot. Notice how shocked the reporter is by her behavior and how Hillary tries to turn it into a joke. but then continues having the seizure. Notice how it was triggered by several different people talking to her at once, which is a known cause of seizures. Is this why Hillary refuses to give press conferences? We see similar traits in this footage, the crazy eye movements, the overreaction to external stimuli, the weird elongated bathroom break in the middle of a televised debate, which insiders said was a flare-up of problems from her brain injury.
And we believe Secretary Clinton will be coming around the corner any minute.
Reports that she can barely stand up after giving a speech. The coughing fits, which is yet another side effect of strokes.
I almost say put her in, man. Just put her in.
Difficulty swallowing, choking, a garbled voice. Again, all side effects of strokes.
It caused nuclear war.
Guess what else is a side effect of strokes? Spontaneous outbursts of laughter that go on for longer than is socially comfortable.
I know Bernie Sanders said that, quote, the American people are sick and tired of hearing about your damn emails. But there are a lot of people who are not.
Well.
including FBI officials.
Some aspects of Hillary's freakish behavior could be explained by the blood clot, but others could be a manifestation of her notoriously unstable personality and even drug abuse. Her sudden, profound, and disproportionate bouts of rage, confirmed by former Secret Service agents, former K-9 handlers, and her own campaign insiders. An anonymous campaign aide told the New York Post that Hillary unleashed, quote, screaming childlike tantrums that have left staff members in tears and unable to work.
Byrne paints a disturbing picture of what he claims Hillary is like behind the scenes.
When something goes wrong, she seems to go right off the scale. Instead of trying to fix what the problem is, she goes right to anger and berates who she holds responsible for.
Byrne told me that as First Lady, Hillary actually hit a Secret Service agent in the back of the head with a Bible.
She became angry about something. She had a Bible in her hand. She didn't actually throw it at him. As he described it to me, she leaned forward and kind of punched him in the hit him in the head with it.
He says the Clinton White House was like a battlefield, and the president showed up one morning with a black eye to prove it.
They even said they had to give her, quote, chill pills to calm her down. These outbursts are likely linked to years of persistent drug abuse. Her susceptibility to rage whenever she's challenged would also explain the complete dearth of press conferences and why her campaign builds human walls to keep reporters away. Hillary is also likely on the autism spectrum. She has virtually no empathy for other people. One expert told me that Hillary has high-functioning autism with attendant sociopathy.
Yep.
We came, we saw, he died.
This would explain the exaggerated expressions. They're to compensate for what psychiatrists call emotional illiteracy. Could this be why her efforts to connect with people seem so forced, so insincere?
I'm just chilling in Cedar Rapids.
There's even speculation that she could have contracted syphilis from sex addict Bill Clinton, which may explain the apparent lesion on her tongue. Then you have the memory lapses. Huma Abedin saying Hillary is, quote, often confused. The pathological lies about being under Bosnian sniper fire. The lies about her email scandal. All signs of cognitive impairment, personality disorder, or both. All this, while the Clinton campaign claims her only issues are allergies and hyperthyroidism. Hillary could be mentally incapacitated and incapable of handling stress even before she takes on the most stressful job in the world. Barack Obama claims Donald Trump is unfit to be president because of his rhetoric. But is Hillary Clinton physically unfit to be president?
She's obviously mentally ill. She's out of control. Evil people, particularly folks like her, rot as they get older mentally. It's just historical fact. And she is a clear and present danger to this republic. Part of me wants her to go ahead and just get in and totally wreck this whole globalist agenda forever. They think she's going to save it. Oh, she'll end it. Unless she has a nuclear war. And this is somebody who has a thing out to dominate women and men, and who's extremely warlike. And the Russians have pegged her. They think she's very, very dangerous and is really going to escalate the situation. And the Pentagon is scared of her. They have a lot of intelligence analysts that have come out and said Hillary is super bad news. I've talked to soldiers, multiple soldiers that protected Hillary Clinton when she was the Secretary of State in Iraq and other countries. And it's like she goes under mind control trance. Well, I'm not even at liberty to tell these stories. I'm just going to stop right there. People wouldn't believe it anyways. This country is in so much trouble, and so is the world. But basically, Hillary just cuts off in a car like a robot. She just sits there and goes into a trance. Well, you know, when they're driving through Baghdad or whatever, something's wrong with her. So Gavin McGinnis with the time zone issues. He thought he was on next hour. But he's going to get here. He'll probably stagger over, be with Anthony Gucciardi as well in the fourth hour today. Really informed guy. Also funny. Founder of Vice. Always fun to see his videos online and to hear his radio show. He's going to be joining us. I want to cover the waterfront, the latest Islamic attacks. France, water park to hold Burkini Day, non-Muslim swimming attire banned. We told you that was coming next. It's all part of henpecking us into submission. It's why Islam, extreme forms of it, obviously, Orthodox Islam, works so well with the left because it's so anti-liberal. But continuing here with what I was getting into, the economic collapse in Venezuela, that people are slaughtering and eating zoo animals. It's gotten that bad. It's just murder in the streets, burning cities, starvation. It's getting worse by the minute. But this is a communist utopia. But don't worry, it pays the biggest amount of money back of any Latin American country, the IMF and World Bank. So they're good little slaves of the New World Order following through with all of that. Now, here's Obama a few years ago saying, you didn't build your business. And now he's come back and said that, you know, if you don't like America, because America's all about big government, get out of America. Even though everybody knows America was supposedly about small government. Here's the clip.
If you've been successful, you didn't get there on your own.
Absolutely not.
You didn't get there on your own. I'm always struck by people who think, well, it must be because I was just so smart. There are a lot of smart people out there. It must be because I worked harder than everybody else. Let me tell you something. There are a whole bunch of hardworking people out there.
Collectivism, claiming your work is somebody else's. Slavery is the name of it.
If you were successful, somebody along the line gave you some help. There was a great teacher somewhere in your life.
Hit pause real quick. This is the essence of class envy. Obviously, your mother gave birth to you and wiped your butt and fed you and took care of you. Obviously, grandma and grandpa did that and daddy did. Obviously, teachers helped you. But to imply, though, that you can't say you built something, if a painter teaches you how to paint, they helped you, but you painted that painting. If Nico, in their books, a guest, or comes up with an idea, or if Matt does, or if Allie does, they did that. If I go lift weights or go jog, I did that. By the way, when I screw up, I did that too. But the idea that, hey, you didn't do that. We all have a right to what you did. Okay, well, on average, the average person in the U.S. pays about 45% in some form of tax. If you're upper middle class, you pay 40% federal tax alone, 65, 70% tax. France has a 75% federal tax on average and a bunch of other taxes at about 90%. On upper middle class and nouveau riche, people making €1 million a year, it's 101% for 5 years running. Totally regressive. To control everyone, because the elites all have loopholes to not pay the tax. They're consolidating power. Now, serfs in ancient Europe had to pay 10 to 20% to the king, to the noble that worked for the king. I pay upwards of 70% in taxes. Is that enough? Can I keep 30%? And let me explain something. The way they've changed the rules, so I have law firms and CPAs. I've gone around. Since Obama got in, I thought it was bad before. They take new equipment and stuff I buy, supposedly is owned by the company and owned by me, and we pay taxes on it every year, and it appreciates out. It's incredible. It's hard to even buy stuff, computers and cameras. And on top of what I pay crew members, I got to match their Social Security and FICA. But see, the average person doesn't run a company, so they don't know. So they hear Obama up there now saying, hey, if you don't think the government did all this and you don't like big government, just get out of here. Here it is. This is yesterday.
And I always tell people who are anti-government here in the United States, try going to a country where the government doesn't work.
Which from a corrupt people like you.
And you'll see that you actually want a good government. It's a useful thing to have. But it's not enough on its own if you also don't have then the ability of people in the private sector.
Yeah, the multinationals coming in to exploit the people. That's why he said communism's good. Remember in South America, Argentina. He said communism is really helpful, but we need internationally multinational corporations that come and work with it. You're a slave under communism, and the big banks come in above the law, land in helicopters, and run your slave factory or run your mine, and you get nothing. But there's guys with red flags and machine guns aimed at you that, you know, rape your wife. So everything is really, really cute and fun. Now, when we come back, Clint Eastwood, Trump challenging Obama's pussy generation. Just effing get over it, 86-year-old actor says. I got to tell you, the biggest all-time actor of all time. And I really love Clint Eastwood's courage. I love all these jackasses go, he's 86 years old. You know, he ought to shut up. This guy still produces and directs movies that, that most of you could never even do. So shut up, you collectivist thumbsuckers. Gavin McGinnis is our guest. He's with us 30 minutes the next hour with Anthony Gucciardi because I got to go to a meeting or I'd be here the next 30 minutes after that, the fourth hour. Gavin McGinnis, Twitter at Gavin_McGinnis. And, of course, he's got his own big media operation. He's one of the guys that founded Vice. Big fan of it back when he ran at CompoundMedia.com and hosts his own global transmission every day. So you can find that. In fact, up against me, which is great. They blow my head off. Gavin McGinnis is still there because I'm not in competition with this guy. I'm in competition with those that want to end competition. Barack Hussein Obama, who we just played the clip saying, government, there's a full speech. I didn't play all of it. It creates everything. You didn't build your business. You know, it's kind of part two of that. The all-out assault on Trump, they're now saying that Melania kept going back and forth and getting visitor visas, and so she might have been illegal, but she then became a citizen, and that she might have been an escort. That's the new attack. Imagine if they were attacking a Democrat's wife saying she might have been an escort. Look, Trump never said lock people up who have escorts, but I don't think she was an escort. The point is that this is getting crazy, and so I'm wondering, where does this go? Where does this go next? So Gavin McGinnis joins us. Where should we start? I mean, I got to say, this is the most entertaining thing I've ever seen. People that say they're bored, Gavin, I don't know what planet they're living on. This is sensational. Everywhere, you can't throw a stick without, you know, hitting some ultra massive sensational incredibleness. I mean, I am actually in heaven right now.
Yeah, I always say that to people at Fox too who aren't on the Trump train. I go, you're an entertainer. This guy is a right-wing entertainer. I don't understand why you don't support him. What are you, crazy? At the very least, even if you're a liberal, you have to admit, this is the first time, and I'm going to say a quarter century, that dads have even cared about an election. They're answering questions on polls. They're asking, Americans are asking details about contested conventions and all this minutia about Congress. For the first time ever, we care, and that's because it's exciting.
So I think we are seeing a major reawakening happening. I threw out quite a platter there. What do you want to tackle first?
Well, this war on Melania is curious, and I was shocked to see the New York Post is doing it because they've been with Trump since the beginning. But it seems like they want to, that Hillary's people, their only card is genitalia, women, women, women. And they've noticed that when you bring up Melania, probably because she's so stunning, that it loses women's vote. I actually met a woman at the airport and she was complaining about Melania. And she's saying, I don't want a whore for the first lady. She yelled that in the airport bar, and I just thought, these women are unhinged. Why did we have the 19th Amendment again?
Well, you think liberals would love the girl-on-girl shoot.
Yeah. No, they have to be ugly for them to like lesbians. They have to be hirsute and be wearing a...
So Janet Reno and Hillary would be okay.
Yeah, they have to be African-American women of color for it to be interesting with really ugly tattoos, you know, masculinized. But they're really going for this emotional vote. And I read an interview with Michael Moore, of all people, and he said 81% of voters are female, visible minority, or young. And those are all, or those are disproportionately emotional groups. And if they could just keep hammering this same propaganda on them, it's going to be a real force to be reckoned with, because the same ones, the dads, are the only ones voting with their brains.
And by the way, it's not like the, quote, women and minorities are getting something going with Hillary and the globalists. They want them even more poor. That's why they target them. I mean, this is so obvious.
That's the frustrating thing, is in progressives, in their mind, it goes like this. There's the left that wants to help the poor and give blacks welfare, and that's nice. And then there's the mean Republicans who want to deny everyone. They're all about austerity, and they say, you don't need money. You're a lazy piece of trash. It's never occurred to them that we here on the right, the libertarians, the conservatives, a lot of the Republicans, we don't like welfare for black people because we don't think it's good for them. And we've seen examples of this time and time again. Look at American Indians. They've been hurt with welfare and freebies. Freebies leave you worse off.
Well, sure. I mean, the reservation was set up to dehumanize them.
Exactly. We didn't evolve to like free stuff. We didn't evolve to get free college. We evolved to have punishment for bad decisions. And if you spent $250,000 taking speech pathology at NYU, you got to be punished. That was a dumb move.
Well, look at how they say don't feed the squirrels at the park. I mean, because they turn into these obese, mindless, lazy creatures.
Yes. Well, they still like to talk about how the poor in America are starving and how there's so many hungry children. John Stossel summed it up best. He said, the biggest problem America has right now is that our poor eat too much.
Well, look, I've been overweight before myself, so a little bit. But I got to tell you, I was in San Antonio yesterday taking care of business, and it's the fattest city in the U.S., and you're driving around, it's like being in the movie WALL-E. I don't hate these people. I feel sorry for them, but, you know, it's crazy. What is going on here?
Yeah, you know, Michelle Obama had a point. She said that we have to watch out for nutrition in schools, and we have something like 500,000 people die of obesity every year. I don't have a problem with you if you're fat. Some of my best friends are fat. I'm fat. But you can't, right now we glorify it and we say it's healthy for you. You're going to be fine. Look at this hot bikini bod this woman has. And you go, look, I'm not judging you, lady, but you're dying. And this is what we keep doing. We keep normalizing bad behavior or vices, really. And we do this with trans. We go, it's good that you're becoming a woman. It's healthy that you're removing your penis. And we're giving children hormone blockers because we're saying it's good that you think you're a woman and you're a man, even though...
Well, my issue is, why do I have to pay for it? I mean, if anybody wants to cut their, you know, their wee-wee off, that's their issue. But why am I paying for it?
And it's child abuse. You give a kid hormone blockers at 10 years old.
No, I agree. That's child abuse.
Chemically, and you're encouraging something that has a brutal suicide rate. So we're now normalizing behavior that is so off the wall that it's dangerous. And look at Salon, by the way, in Slate, normalizing pedophilia and saying, don't call them child molesters if they haven't molested children. They're just pedophiles.
I notice you're, for TV viewers can see it, obviously. Radio listeners can't. You're wearing Make America Great Again, the classic red hat. You've got a Trump, Make America Great Again, white shirt. I guess you're in the suburbs of New York. You were describing to me during the break what it's like when you're on the train and people see this. What do they do?
Yeah, it's a funny city to wear this shirt in because New York changes so fast and there's so many different... Like, people think of New York as just the Upper West Side, rich liberals who read the New York Times, and that's definitely a big contingent. But there's the blue collars, the retired cops, there's Coney Island, there's all the immigrants, there's the yuppies, there's the rich girl blogger feminist with the blue hair. So you get off at different stops on the subway, and you're in different culture. And I was in Williamsburg today and Manhattan, and in Williamsburg, when the hipsters see the shirt, you'd think they'd go like, screw you, but there's an air of capitulation. And they sort of just bow their heads. I think deep down they want to be dominated by Trump. And they know that their version of events isn't better. Like, they call it creative destruction, but it's really just sabotage. They want to wipe out traditionalism. And then you go, all right, what do you got? And they go, I don't know. You know, they did that with gender. They go, male and female is too restrictive. And you go, okay, what do you got? And they give us four more. And then they go, is that it? No. And they keep giving us more. And I realize, you're like ISIS. You're insatiable. You don't know what you want. You need...
I was about to say, they want to blow up traditionalism. Western traditionalism is what is the fount of true liberalism and all the choices. They're trying to blow up the source of all their damn freedom.
And you create a vacuum when you do that. And you know who fills in the vacuum? Not progressives, but ISIS, but immigrants, but Sharia law. As soon as you say marriage doesn't matter, then someone else moves in who's a polygamist and says, okay, we're going to do five Muslim wives who have to wear garbage bags on their head.
I was about to say, though, why does the left, we talk a lot about this, but they don't just go along with Islam. They love it. It's like they're so mad at Christians that don't want to bake a cake, but then they totally want to flip out and just bow down and make excuses for the most radical, foaming-at-the-mouth cavemen Islamicists.
It's bizarre, and I've spent hours trying to figure it out. The only thing I can do is come up with some sort of Freudian theory about daddy issues where they go, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. I notice that my dad's uncomfortable when I'm a lesbian, when I'm not married. My dad gets uncomfortable when I take how to be gay in college. My dad gets uncomfortable when I support Islam. Okay, I like all those things. And you're sitting there as a dad going, you realize that most of those are not what's good for you. And Islam will wipe you out. You liberals will be the first to go if we get Sharia law in this country. The white male patriarchy that they hate so much is the one that gives them the most freedom, the most leeway.
So really, it's a bunch of spoiled brats, and then now they're just letting the robber in the front door, even though the robber's going to hog time and rape them.
Exactly. It's a real problem with this country, and I'm an immigrant from Canada, and I'm very grateful to be here. And one thing you notice, Ayan Hirsi Ali talks about this. She goes, these people have had nothing but freedom. They don't know how lucky they are. And as an entrepreneur from Canada who had to be punished by the government every time I came up with an idea, I am so thankful to be in a place where you can incorporate for $1,000 in Delaware and start your business the next day. These Americans don't know how lucky they are. And if one person, I'm glad you brought up Obama. If there's one person who doesn't understand the entrepreneur, it's Barack Obama. I mean, here's one tiny thing that is huge that no one gets if they haven't started a business. For every success, I estimate you have 12 failures. So when you go to a water park like Great Wolf Lodge, know that those brothers from Madison, Wisconsin, who started that, had a dozen brutal failures where their wives were thinking of leaving them, where they were overdrawn at the bank, where they were looking forward into an abyss of bankruptcy. They kept plugging away and they made it. But someone like Barack comes along who's never really done anything like that, and he goes, well, someone just gave you a water park. You used my roads to get to your water park, so you owe me half.
Even though it was the people's money that built the roads to begin with.
Yes, and you better not say that in New York, because when I go upstate, I pay at least $40 in tolls coming back and forth. So the roads here are not free, and we still have to struggle to get our taxes below 50%. I mean, New York is communist in a lot of ways, and these ingrates think it should be more. These anarchist punks who hate rules want more regulation.
I was about to say, everything's upside down. All the anarchists I see have Mao Zedong or Lenin or Stalin tattoos. They have red flags. They pull up in like brand new sports cars. And then they're calling themselves anarchists. They're the opposite of an anarchist. They're a statist little tick.
And it's frustrating. Like, at least with slavery, you go, all right, blacks would be the first to go. And there's an argument that they wouldn't be. And maybe you'd need the labor. But with these artistic creative types and Mao, you go, I don't have to conjecture that you'd be the first to go. I saw he killed 77 million. The creative types were at the top of the list. So you're wishing your own suicide. It really is a form of self-hatred.
No, I agree. It's mass Stockholm syndrome, unconscious suicide, because no one beat the hell out of them when they were a kid. And I'm not saying it's great to be like that, but you know, most of us growing up at least had some rough times, had to get a job. I mean, the best thing ever happened to me was rough stuff. And I think it's that they've never had legitimate suffering. They don't know how good they've got it. So subconsciously, they're trying to commit suicide, but take us with them.
Couldn't agree more. And you can tell when someone's never been punched in the face. You can tell by the way they talk that they've never, ever had a moment where they go, oh, wow, there's ramifications for stuff I say. And another factor, by the way, outside of the awesome bullying that we all went through that was ultimately great for us, is kids. You know, you got someone like Angela Merkel. She doesn't have kids. She is purposely sabotaging her country, her culture. It's really like a mass shooting. She's sort of, I know I'm going to die. I'm going to take as many Germans down with me as I can.
What do you think's behind the $5 million they brought in there? They tried to cover it up. What they're doing here, daily stabbings, murders, bombings, and then the guy's named Ali, they changed the name to David. I mean, this is beyond 1984. I mean, I don't know how they created such a freakazoid cult.
Well, here's what's going on here. They see themselves as superior to the masses, the dirty, unwashed masses, because they're communists. And communists ultimately are like monarchs. They have a hierarchy in their mind, and they will control the good like Obama, and he will dole out the good as he sees fit to those who deserve it, because we're too stupid to handle it. Alex and Gavin, they would just sort of feed their faces and then buy Ferraris and crash them into a fence post. So they go, here, I'm going to dole it out evenly. And what the media is also like that. Angela Merkel and the German press and the French politicians and the French press, they all say, I'm not going to report this too accurately because I don't want to start a race war and I don't want there to be too much animosity. And you go, wait a minute. I thought your job was reporting on things. No, no, no. My job is slowly doling out the information and deciding what you are capable of. And then we find out, what was this, a couple weeks ago, that at Bataclan, they were castrating victims, taking out their testicles and putting it into these guys' mouths.
That's liberal.
As they die. And the press and the government cut that detail out because we're too stupid to handle it. We would get too mad and we're too irrational. So just like all political correctness is someone telling me what words to use for black and it's African-American this year and it's person of color, it's basically these Victorians, right? These modern Victorians.
It's all to make you feel insecure. You can never reach the level, the benchmark. We're just all guilty.
Yes. And the irony is they're telling us about things that they've never tried that we live in. And that's why I love that you didn't build that. I can't recommend this book enough, Michelle Malkin, Who Built That, where she's pretty apolitical about it. And she just goes through the guys who invented air conditioning, the guy, Maglite, flashlight, the Roeblings who built the steel bridges, all these great stories of entrepreneurs. And you just think, I wish I could force Obama and all these communists to read this. Because when you read about entrepreneurs, the people who built the Western world, you don't see these greedy, you know, rappers on jet skis. You see guys working their fingers to the bone for the betterment of society in general. I mean, look at air conditioning alone.
Because there's an instinctive need to build things and innovate in the highest levels of the human spirit, transcending things. And Gavin McGinnis is our guest. You're absolutely right. You look at communist countries, they can't even ever make cars. They have to buy their ships and tank factories from somebody else. I mean, look at North Korea. Look how South Koreans are even beating out the Japanese as innovators now. The North can't make a car. Look at the Russians, some of the best mathematicians and engineers in the world. Under communism, they can hardly make cars. I mean, it's so obvious that the claim that the state creates stuff is pure baloney.
I know, and it goes, I keep going back to evolution, which ultimately is code for God. I don't like to say God around atheists because they shut their ear holes, but
sure.
Isn't it curious that when we go against evolution and we say, actually, I'm going to go against this 250,000-year-old pattern of hunting a woolly mammoth, throwing a spear, getting a woolly mammoth, and just start doling out woolly mammoths to people and see how it goes. What you're doing there is you're playing God. And when you play God, you're messing with his formula, and it ultimately blows up in your
face. That's right, the animating contest of running them down, running them over the side of a cliff, and then cutting it up and processing it for the winner, or you die. It's not work, it creates a culture. Instead, imagine just people sitting around with woolly mammoth meat being dropped by helicopters, we wouldn't be here.
Austerity works, and that's why you see so much innovation. And I'm sorry, but if you're near the equator, you're not under duress. If you don't have Siberian winters in your history, you tend not to be as tenacious because the non-tenacious die. And I remember, I can't remember who it was that asked Vicente Fox when he was president of Mexico. They said, what have you come up with? What have you invented? And he talked about the Aztecs and the Mayan calendar and all this stuff. And they said, no, let's do the past 100 years. And he goes, the taco? It's not even that handy of a food, really. It's got nothing on it.
Now, wait a minute. Don't bash Mexican food. It has innovated quite a bit.
You eat it at an angle, and then it's falling out the side. It gets in your beard.
It's innovated my belt size. Hey, stay there. Gavin McGinnis, it is true. The studies at Ice Age civilizations, whether it be Japan or Europe or whatever. Now, to be fair to Mesoamerican culture, they were big on tracking the stars and mathematics and things like that. But like other cultures, it doesn't matter whether it was a northern culture or equatorial culture, they would get into the occult, into cultures of government control. As soon as populations became agrarian, there was actually too much food, is what Gavin was getting at. And so the decadence would set in, and a ruling class could hold back the food that they had everybody else basically plant. And so a form of caste slavery came in. And caste slavery didn't do too well in northern frozen climes. And a lot of sociologists, anthropologists, archaeologists have pointed this out. So that's why you see a lot of innovations going on in more inhospitable places, because that which doesn't kill you only makes you stronger. And it's actually the plenty, nothing to do with IQs, it's just the plenty creates a decadence. And now look at us today. No matter what color we are dying because we have just been put in an artificial. It's kind of like going to Mars. You get there in a year and a half, you can't walk when you get off the spaceship because there's been no gravity. I mean, is that what you're getting at, Gavin?
Yeah, that is exactly what I'm getting at. It often feels like we're in the future. Look at how many different programs we do to try to go backwards in time and mimic a better work ethic or a more traditional society, like going to the gym. I mean, we used to be on the farm every day. You'd work 11 hours tilling the land, and you'd come home exhausted and just have a meal and crash. Now we're not exercising enough, so we go out and we run on a treadmill. I mean, if people could see us walking up and down these computer stairs, these fake stairs, and walking on treadmills, they'd be stunned. And then with all
I was about to say, they've dug up people from 10,000 years ago in England, and the average person was like stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger or an Olympic lifter. I mean, these people would rip your arm out of your socket.
Yeah, you had to. And I keep talking to people, and they go, you know, like I was talking to a comedian the other day, and he goes, I'm really getting into Buddhism. I'm getting into meditation because I get too stressed out. And I realized, you're an atheist. You threw Catholicism away, even though you grew up like that. What you're talking about is Latin Mass. Or they go to rehab. That's 40 days. That's Lent. So I think we're in the future in many ways. It's a lot like WALL-E, where we've had so much splendor and so many gifts that we almost have to reinforce discipline and make ourselves suffer.
I agree with you. So how do we do that, Gavin?
Well, we try to improve ourselves. Here's the thing. Like, this conversation tends to drift into race, and I never wanted it to go there. It's when these lefties go, well, that's racist, and that's white male. And then we go, oh, really? I never really checked. And then you look around and you go, oh, yeah, I guess there are some white males there, but that's not where we go. We're Western chauvinists. And I started this group called the Proud Boys. We have meetings every month. We beat the crap out of each other until we can name five breakfast cereals. We all have tattoos that say Proud Boy. And we are proud of our testosterone and our masculinity. And we're noticing that these women appreciate it too. We need to get back to this concept that the patriarchy is not the worst thing that's happened to civilization. It is civilization. And if you have a better plan...
Well, the patriarchy is having a brother that if somebody attacks you, no matter how old you are, the brother's going to come kill him. Instead, women are just all alone to have punk men beat them up.
And you see this living in the city, living in New York City for 15 years. You know, someone has a sip of a drink. Richard Schwartz, by the way, who was working on Trump's campaign, was telling me this the other day. He goes, I'm walking up the stairs in the subway, and I see a big gulp that's just sitting on the stairs. And he goes, can you imagine yourself having a big gulp and going, all right, I'm done with this, and just putting it down on public stairs and walking away? It's a mentality that means I don't like you. And I think a big part of this mentality, this sort of disconnect from society.
That's right. It's a religion of crapping all over everyone and not caring about anybody but yourself. It's like crapping in the pool. I mean, they actually have the Islamics coming crap in the pool. It's like, look, when you crap in the pool, it ruins it for everyone, dummy. But they're getting off on that moment crapping in the pool, even though it's going to close it for the next 2 days. And so it's those of us that don't want to crap in the pool versus people that want to crap in the pool. We'll be back in 70 seconds with hour number four. Gucciardi's coming in 5 minutes. But I'm going to finish up with my good friend. Who's going to continue on with Anthony? CompoundMedia.com is with us. We got time zones messed up. Another 30 minutes. Anthony Gucciardi's going to come in, finish the interview. I love the angles he's going with. And then he has a lot of the news he's going to cover. Briefly, free shipping this week on everything at InfoWarsStore.com. We kept three of the nutraceuticals also at 40% off and 30% off. But DNA Force is going to sell out. Brain Force is going to sell out. And we're going to sell out, too. We got more coming in, though, so probably won't sell out. Vitamin Mineral Fusion. These are just really good nutraceuticals, top of the line, very low prices. And then with your free will, you fund an operation that just promotes liberty and freedom. Gavin, first off, thanks for joining us. In closing here with you and I, obviously you're going to be with Gucciardi for two segments. Do you think humanity's on the march? Because I do think we're kind of rediscovering our roots, or am I being too optimistic?
I think a great way to gauge that is you know, the canary in a coal mine. I remember 5-10 years ago, Alex Jones was this crazy guy who is always fighting the government, and that's nuts because the government's right most of the time. So he's out of his mind, and he probably believes people are reptiles. Today, InfoWars is like Breitbart. People don't say that's, well, a few crazy liberals do, but most sane people go, yeah, InfoWars is saying da 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 da. Breitbart is saying da 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 da. It's just a very reliable news source, and it turns out that this so-called nut was right. And you see this with lots of people. Jim Goad used to be considered a total freak. Now he's a wise old sage. Steve Saylor, Peter Brimelow, Jared Taylor, V-Dare, all of these sites, American Enterprise. And look at Charles Murray. Charles Murray wrote Coming Apart, where he said, we are out of touch with the working class, and we're building this ivory tower of academics and media pundits and politicians who don't know what average people go through. And it's almost like Nostradamus, like it couldn't have become more true. And now the social justice warriors, who seemed like freedom riders 10 years ago, are now the laughingstock. Everyone sees them as the church.
Well, I agree. So as bad as it is, it's a paradox. I mean, they are a laughingstock now. And seriously, what they do to me is every day, and I'm not exaggerating, but let's not exaggerate, 50 times a day. I mean, so many I can't. They go, Alex Jones believes in space aliens and lizard people. And I say, I'm sure there's life in space. I don't know what's going on, but I don't believe all that. They misrepresent, or they say that I believe in Bigfoot. Never talked about Bigfoot. So they can't beat what we're saying. They just or they say, he doesn't like black people. When the hell did I say that? They just stuff up. They just make it up.
Well, that's the beauty of the information age, because they go, really? He hates black people? And then all it takes is one person to go look it up and go, actually, he never said that. And it's just such a great defense in the information age, because someone could just grab their phone and go, yeah, he never said that. Like, oh, Trump said that all Mexicans and Muslims have to be deported? Show me where he said that. Find me that sentence.
There was another one. They even have the fake right wing attack me. They go, Alex Jones has attacked street preachers. And I wasn't even my person. I was interviewing somebody, and they said, these people discredit Christians, screaming in everyone's face. I think they have a First Amendment. Sometimes I think they're obnoxious. But the point is, I never said that. So the new thing is to attack me from the controlled right and say that I'm attacking street preachers. Just made up. But you know what? I think that's the last gasp of the mainstream media, yeah, that they have to lie about everything.
It's the death knell. And they have all these little things that are indications that they're a dying animal. They sound like roadkill, just having their last gasp. And my favorite one is, look, I know political correctness has gotten out of hand with some things, but last time I checked, it was just people treating other people with respect. I've heard that sentence 100 times, and it really is just sort of a...
So what replaces it, though?
Freedom, liberty, free speech. I mean, the government is actually not bad when it comes to free speech. It's the people. We are more Orwellian to each other than the government is. The government won't get you fired for making a speech, but your coworkers will cause a big stink. Twitter will get you fired. They'll contact your boss. There'll be a boycott.
That's right. It's a modern witch hunt. It's a modern witch hunt.
Pardon me?
It's a modern witch hunt.
It's Salem all over again. And the thing that drives me nuts is, say it was Salem, right? And your husband gets picked up for wearing black. Your wife should go, what the hell is going on here? People can't wear black. But in this culture now, your wife would go, why were you wearing black? You know it's Salem. You know it's the witch hunts. And you go,
hold on, stay there. You're going to take over. Finish up with Salem straight ahead. Gavin McGinnis is our guest. Gucciardi.
That's right. This is The Resistance. And if you're listening, we're going to talk about some real things, not just what the media wants to force down your throat as a talking point that no one actually cares about. And we've got Gavin McInnes, also via Skype in studio. We're going to talk about a lot of interesting things. Political correctness. This story here also. CNN, I just grabbed it, printed it before the show. CNN show trashes Trump 200 times more than covering Obama's $400 million Iran payment. So even if you don't like Trump, it doesn't even matter. They won't even talk about the real things anymore because they're too busy trashing Trump. All they care about now is trashing Trump and how mean he is and whether Melania was in some photos in a magazine or whatever. Oh, my word, right? They're just constantly getting triggered, I guess. We're going to talk about political correctness. We're going to talk about the burkini-only day at French water parks. We're going to talk about Rio Olympics. It's politically incorrect to criticize that. Chinese hurdler vomited on and robbed of luggage. Danish Olympic team hit by thieves. They couldn't get in the gate of their own event, the officials. Lots and lots of stuff. But Gavin McInnes from CompoundMedia.com. His Twitter is at Gavin_McInnes. He's an entrepreneur, a comedian. He's just a very, very all-around interesting guy with a lot of good points. So, Gavin, glad to have you back. It was a good segment with Alex for sure. So, first and foremost, let's hit this right away. All the articles I have before me, a lot of them are about political correctness, right? It's about, like, people getting so upset and so offended. And I believe that at the end of the day, it's all a bunch of BS. And it reminds me of how the Washington Post found that 9 out of 10 Native Americans weren't offended by the Redskins name. And if you remember, they were like, oh, the Redskins, that's such a racist, offensive name to Native Americans. And it was all the white people and other whatever in the media saying how offended the Native Americans are. They're not even offended at all. I mean, do you think the majority of people are really just saying this is totally absurd or what?
Yeah, I'm married to an Indian. I made a bunch of Indians. And I remember reading in early 2000s that the number was about 4% for them caring. And then it became the thing to do. And we have the president saying, I would change the name if I were you. Then it went up really high. And I could tell it was fake. See, that's what happens with these things. When you lay out the red carpet of griping, a lot of people go, yeah, I'm going to take it. And they jump on board. And so Indians did care for about a year when it was the hot thing. And then it went back to the normal number, which is zero. Indians named their own teams Redskins.
And, you know, here's what's funny, too. We're going to talk about, you know, what you learned through being an entrepreneur and actually gaining gratitude and appreciating things. But I've got a story here about the first modern man from 3200 BC in National Geographic. And you think about his problems. We won't get too much into it, but they identified this person who is the first modern man with a name. So like the first story, what he did and everything. You think about his problems, right? Maybe not dying of starvation, maybe not dying in a tribal attack, right? Maybe not getting a spear through his gut, feeding his family, whatever. Think about his problems, and now think about the modern day problems. We've condensed them into, instead of the real things that are issues, into getting triggered on Twitter, right? So you think about thousands of years ago, we were so upset about tribes coming in and killing our families and not getting enough food, and now we're just as upset about politically incorrect statements on Twitter and Facebook. I mean, what do you think about that? Our problems now are absurd.
Well, it's amazing. I saw this thing the New York Times put together, and it was all these horrible discoveries they've made while embedded in the Trump followers movement, whatever you want to call it, for a year. And they got one N-word and one Zeke Heil over a year of camping out with these guys. And before they aired the segment, they said, warning, some dangerous content may offend some viewers. And I thought, imagine being 89, 92 years old or something, having been in World War II, and seeing someone need a warning on their screen before they look at a year of Trump protesters.
You actually think about it.
Yeah, there it is. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
No, yeah, go ahead.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. It starts out with a huge warning before they just show you some of the most benign stuff you've ever seen. And you think, you don't have to go back to cave.
Exactly. Hey, we are losing your Skype feed a little bit there, but we were playing on screen there. Yeah. So it's warning. We lost McInnes right now. We'll get him back on as soon as we can. But it's like, warning. This could be offensive just watching Trump protesters. How about watching, just watching the protesters that we have on the Alex Jones channel, things they say, right? I mean, God, if you even ask someone a question, they start cursing you out. Looks like we got McInnes back. But what do you think about that? When you ask these people questions now, they start screaming at you and cursing at you, like any question at all.
Yeah, I know why that is. Because they spent $200,000 on this Marxist rhetoric. And when you question it, they realize what a house of cards their entire foundation is, their entire ideology. And it becomes a crippling an awakening where they go, oh my God, I don't really know anything. And so they panic and they start screaming. And you see this at protests, they'll use like an air horn, meh, meh, in your face when you try to talk, or they use bull horns, or they spit in your face. They spit in your face. And I try to get these people on my show all the time to debate them, even though it gets real boring because they haven't looked up anything. But they don't want to debate because they're not in it for truth. They're in it for the culture that's a sports team to them.
And, you know, it's funny. So as an entrepreneur yourself, right, you touched on it early in the segment. I thought you made an interesting point. I'm an entrepreneur too. And it's anyone, though, not just entrepreneurship, anyone that's worked hard to get where they are, anyone that has drive, anyone that has passion for something, they also understand gratitude, right? Like when you appreciate nothing, you learn to appreciate. When you have nothing, you learn to appreciate everything. But what we have now is people that work for nothing, refuse to do anything, and appreciate nothing. So they don't understand the gravity of the situation. Like you were saying, the innovators throughout time, the people that built not only cities, countries, culture, everything, spent blood. You think about all the people that fought and died for all this, and not in like a hoorah way, like, oh, America. I'm talking about real innovators from wherever that did all these things and built everything. And then you basically have these people that come in that have never been told, never done anything. They bought into the system lie, the establishment lie, which you were alluding to earlier. You know, they've been told, yeah, just study hard and go to school and you'll be fine.
And by the way, this is everyone too. Talk to LeBron James. It's all about failure. Any professional athlete, any entrepreneur, any rich person, the plus side, which is what you see, is a tiny fraction of his culture. His culture is failure. It's failing again and again and again and getting back up. It's the same with getting laid, actually. Anyway, any guy's got a hot girlfriend, hit on a lot of other girls, and he got turned down a lot of other times. But that's what I love about this book I was plugging earlier, because Alex started the whole thing talking about you didn't build that and Barack's attitude. The Roeblings, who built the Brooklyn Bridge, have a fascinating path that goes back to hand-making rope, which everyone used to do. You'd sit there and you'd twine it all. It took hours and hours and dozens of people. And then they got into using wires to do that. And John Roebling, I can't remember which Roebling it was, but the guy who started the Brooklyn Bridge lost his foot. He crushed his foot while he was building that thing. He watched it from a giant clock tower nearby as his son and his wife completed the project. I mean, these guys were not World War II vets, but even these entrepreneurs lost lives making our lives better. I mean, Manhattan would be nothing without the Brooklyn Bridge.
It is amazing. And you think about also, you see the photos of the construction workers just working. There's just a massive amount of risk. They could fall down. People were falling down all the time. They didn't care. They were building something they believed in. They were doing what they believed in. And they weren't even, it's not like they were making that much money at the time, right? So these were people
died. There was dozens of men who died just doing the groundwork for the bridge because they didn't know what the bends were. They were dying as they came up from working on the rocks down under the water. And look, we're not asking, by the way, for a parade for these people. We don't want giant memorials. But when you start crapping on the people who built civilization and you start talking about the patriarchy and you start scoffing at tradition and telling dads they're horrible people and everyone is a rapist and stuff, you go, you know what? I didn't ask you to get a tattoo of me, but this whole, like, I'm responsible for everything gets a little annoying after a while.
You know, that's what's funny, too, is no one's sitting here saying, you know, these people should be worshipped and look all that. It's just the blatant disregard for every single thing we've been actually built for, that we can enjoy now. It's almost like everything Obama's saying is just a really, really terrible version of what we're saying. You see what I'm saying? In the sense that we should appreciate these things. We should continue to build things. He's saying, you didn't do anything. No, you know, everyone gave you everything. Those people are bad. It's a complete disgrace. It's absurd. And you also think about what we had to endure with coal miners getting black lung, dying. The breaker boys, they would sort coal. Their hands would get all bloody down to the bone. They would die of black lung. All those people did that so we could get to this point and not so we could crap all everything like you just said. And people just want the ultimate, the like you said, finding an attractive girl, right? They just want the hot girl. They just want the money. They just want the success. They don't want to do any of the failure. They don't want to go through any of the process. They want instant gratification right now. And that is when we get to the point where someone's triggered by a Twitter post because they're upset and they demand the police arrest somebody.
Do you have kids?
I do not have kids.
How old are you?
How old do you think? I'm in my 20s.
Okay, well, it's time to shape up.
I know. I'm feeling hard, man.
All these people who worked hard to build bridges and air conditioning and flashlights, they also survived the bubonic plague and world wars and different conquests. So you could get to that desk. Now, I assume you're with an attractive lady. If it's been more than 6 months and you guys are living together and you haven't had a drop down, drag out fight, put a ring on it. Get a ring on it, knock her up, and make some more U's.
That's some good advice right there. And hey, also, no, I do appreciate all my ancestry that led me to this point. Consider the fact that millions and millions of people died and their genetic line is over. All right, we're going to be right back with Gavin McInnes and cover some more news, Rio, and more. This is The Alex Jones Show. Stay tuned. That's right. It's The Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi talking about some serious stuff and having some fun with Gavin McInnes of CompoundMedia.com, Twitter at Gavin_McInnes. He is an entrepreneur, a comedian. You know, it's a funny thing about being a comedian. Not only can you get away with a lot of things, which I like, but it's really the best way to reach people. So many people take themselves too seriously, And everybody is just in this weird shell where you're not allowed to say certain things. But when you add the element of comedy in there, it shatters it all. So Gavin, who's also, by the way, appointed himself to my relationship coach as of this program, telling me I need to have more children and get married, so I can appreciate that advice. But Gavin, tell us a little bit about, you know, why you chose to do comedy, and then we're going to talk about the Rio Olympics and everything like that. But it doesn't help you reach more people?
Yeah, it's just naturally who you are. I think 5% of people are funny, and as you can tell from watching this, I'm hilarious.
Clearly, yes.
The comedy scene, though, is so left-wing and so anti-Trump, it's bizarre. And I think it has a lot to do with daddy issues. Most comedians don't have dads. Most comedians' dads are disappointed in them. So they'll vote for any non-dad candidate. But I find videos and movies is a great way to get your message across using comedy. And you get away from stand-up and all these uptight people. But even making movies and stuff, it's amazing how much political correctness has polluted the entire genre. All of being funny has been seriously marred by PC and liberal culture. And that's actually good. Because when they were messing with conservatives and they were messing with Roe v. Wade and all this other stuff, no one really cared about that. But when you mess with someone's comedy, when Jerry Seinfeld is saying, what the hell is going on here? When Chris Rock is refusing to do colleges, all of a sudden people go, so wait, who are these little brats that are wrecking my fun? And they screwed themselves by doing that.
You know, it's funny because you look at some of the best comedians back in the so-called day, and comedy is the best avenue. Just shred things. You can make a joke out of anything. You look at the ridiculousness of something. You could look at like Richard Pryor style. You could just dig into stuff so easy in a way you could never, ever, ever do in politics, and it gets the point across.
And it was a lot less left-wing. I mean, Lenny Bruce was all about free speech, the First Amendment. Today, all these same comedians are about, like Sarah Silverman saying that these college students are on the right side of history. My friend, and I like Sarah, by the way, my friend Jim Norton, whom I adore, was also saying that these people are on the right side of history, these PC people. And I think it's because a lot of these people, and I'm not including Jim and Sarah in this, but a lot of these comedians, they want a TV gig. So they know that one N-word or one racial thing or one sexist or homophobic thing anywhere on my record, and I could blow my TV gig. So it's made them total and utter pussies. And when you're worried about this, ironically, it's Sarah Silverman who said this. She goes, when you're worried about how someone will interpret a joke, you kill the joke. It's like a painting. And if you work on a little too long or a little too little, you ruin it. And the great evidence there is stutter. If you're saying a joke and you stutter towards the end, the whole joke is ruined and no one will laugh. That's how fragile it is. And these people are going in there with political correctness and just blowing up the entire thing. They're ruining movies. They ruined Ghostbusters. They're ruining stand-up comedy. They're ruining sketches, TV sketches and stuff, and stuff like that. It reached a breaking point this year, and 2017, the rest of 2016, we're not going to see this anymore. I can't say it enough. Listen to the Zombies song, "This Will Be Our Year," because this really is our year. They bent it and it broke.
Because it's not actually about not being racist, not being sexist. I know I'm not racist. I know I'm not sexist. I know I actually empower people way more so than all of the people that claim that we're so racist and sexist, right? But it's more about word domination and ideological domination.
Yes.
Political correctness is not expounding ideas. It's not extrapolating on free thought. It's censoring. It is literal censorship. So you're talking about forming a joke. Now you have to worry about, even me speaking right now, is this going to offend someone? And not because I actually hate that person or that group or whatever. I'm totally not racist, totally not sexist. But now I have to worry about if someone's going to construe it like that. So what happens is you put a limiter on your brain, like a car limiter, and you can only go so far now. And you're breaking that, you know, good for you. We're trying to break
well,
it here, right?
That's what I really resent about it. It's one thing to tell me I can't drive somewhere or I can't dress like this in this establishment. That's one parameter. But when you start getting into my brain and telling me what my motives are wrong, or I'm not allowed to think that, especially when I'm not even sure where I was going with that, and you're telling me what I was thinking, like the CEO of Mozilla, what was his name again? Brendan Eich?
He donated to something he believed in and got obliterated, right?
And we don't know what his motive was. I mean, maybe He's gay, and he doesn't like gays getting married because it's too conformist. Maybe he loves gay marriage, but his dad's last wish...
See, that's too much thought. That's too much thought. All right, Gavin McInnes, we got to go to break. It's been great talking to you. I don't know if you're going to want to hold over or not, but the Gavin McInnes' website is compoundmedia.com. Check him out. Thanks a lot. Censorship has a new name. It's tolerance. Don't you want to be tolerant? That sounds way better. It sounds even cool and trendy and fun. Being tolerant is the new thing. Oh, but wait a minute. It's not about being tolerant because I am tolerant. It's about censorship. It's about limiting scope. It's about providing favor to certain people, the exact same thing that it says that it wants to protect. Example is this: Burkini Only Day at French Water Park criticized. Well, I would hope so, because you're banned unless you're wearing a burkini. It says a water park in France is to be booked out for one day to Muslim women wanting to wear burkinis. But the decision has led to criticism by politicians on the right. Well, on the right, well, it seems like it should lead to criticism from everybody, because I thought this whole thing was we're being tolerant. If someone wants to wear a burkini at the pool, great, good for them. Who cares? But I'm not allowed to go to the pool, or I guess rather some woman is not allowed to go to the pool in a bikini. That sounds like exactly the opposite of what's supposed to happen. Now imagine if we had a Muslim free day at the pool. Okay. That would really, really upset people, wouldn't it, Gavin McInnes from compoundmedia.com? Wouldn't that upset people? But see, they're allowed to say that only Muslims, I mean, unless you're going to wear a burkini and not be a Muslim, which would not be the case, are allowed to be at the pool this day. It is literally every single thing that they're saying that they're, you know, against with, oh, it's so politically correct. What do you think about that?
Yeah, didn't Sarkozy try to ban the burqa? I thought the burqa was banned there. This is what's going on here. We are so tolerant of everything. We're tolerant of the intolerant. So these women come from a culture that is sexist, no matter how you slice it. And we are tolerating their intolerance. They can't be around us, so we tolerate their inability to deal with Western women in bikinis. And I will guarantee you that within no amount of time, this burkini day is going to offend Muslims because they are insatiable. So there's going to be some sort of problem. The burkinis will be too lavish. There'll be too many colors used in them. The burkini hours will be too long. Men will be too tempted to go. I guarantee you that the Muslims will have a problem with this because, like liberals, they're insatiable. And when you give them an inch, they take a mile.
Now, look, for me, my view is we don't even have to debate any elements of the religion or so-called left, so-called right. It's easy because we can just say, wow, this is illogically stupid, right? So We can look at it and say, burkini only day. Let's just say it's potato sack only day. And there's a religion of people that wear potato sacks. It's still horrible. I mean, how about no Muslim day, like I said, would be horrible. It's absurd. It's the reverse, though. It's that they say you have to tolerate, which is another form of actual censorship in this case, because tolerism is good. I should walk around and not scream racial slurs at people. I am not racist. I should tolerate people's existence. But this is not tolerance. This is forced upon you, and it's a mandatory form of domination.
Well, it's treating them like they're diseased, too. I mean, if you had some sort of horrible peanut allergy and there was a restaurant that said, we're going to have peanut-free day, and all these people with this strange affliction, they can come in here and know they're not going to break out in hives. Or we're going to have, you know, cancer patient day, where no one will stare at you if you're bald from chemo, because everyone will look like that. Well, I'm afraid that Muslim isn't some sort of medical affliction. It's not a condition. It's not a disease. So to treat this like we have to tenderly walk around them on eggshells and make sure they're okay with their horrible disease is almost just as demeaning as Islamophobia. Look, you came over here. You have to follow the culture of the place you moved to. You think we would get away with Big Tit Day in Afghanistan?
That's actually, yeah, that's funny. And it is also a form of discrimination against them to treat it like, you know, well, you're safe here. And it brings me to this point. I also want to add that, you know, in kindergarten now, they have pictures of white people and black people. And there's kindergartners running around. They don't even care about any of this absurdity. And they'll say, this is a black person. This is a white person. This is a male. This is a female. And the kindergartner's like, what? And I've seen so many emails and screenshots of these types of things sent in from parents. And the kindergartners are like, what? This is just my best friend. I don't understand. They're like, this is a black person. This is a white person. Except. And the kindergarten's like, What? I accept everybody. I love everybody. It's when you make it such a big issue. That's what's actually racist.
Yeah. And, you know, as a parent, which you'll soon learn if you follow my plan, that's one of your biggest goals. There's the Santa thing. There's hiding 9/11. And there's not letting them know that race is a thing. They should just see that someone is darker than someone. And it's going to happen inevitably. They're going to learn that there's this big hullabaloo about melanin. But your goal as a parent, among other forms of innocence, like sex, is to delay that for as long as possible and to keep them, I'm sorry, but naive as possible for as long as you can. And then these schools come in and they go, you know that he's basically a slave and you're a plantation owner, right? And you go, first of all, that's not true. But secondly, will you shut up and stop showing them pornos, basically racial porn, when they're 8 years old, when they're four years old?
And you said naive, and I would say it's not even naivete. Sure. It's more like stopping them from buying into the lie, because it's almost like, no, it's not being naive to just not be racist. I mean, it's like, it's truly, we should model ourselves after what children do. They don't care about any of this. You think they're sitting around arguing about religious and political beliefs with other kindergartners? No. Or the color of their skin or the differences they have? No, absolutely not. It's not even an issue. It's only an issue when the media over and over again tries to make an issue. And I will remind everybody of this. CNN show trashes Trump 200 times more than covering Obama's $400 million Iran payment. Gee, is the warped reality media trying to force something down your throats? Yeah, they are. That's why every single time anything happens, they just push the angle. If it bleeds, it leads. And they are the ones driving this fake narrative that no one's even buying. Thoughts on
that? You got to check out this movie. I think it's almost 10 years old now. Media Malpractice. And it was all about the Obama campaign. Oh, no, this would only be 4 years old, sorry. It's about the Obama campaign with Sarah Palin and how CNN, Anderson Cooper especially, was obsessed with Sarah Palin's $100,000 wardrobe. And CNN went on and on about it dozens of times. Yet Reverend Wright, the only time it would come up was for Anderson Cooper to discredit it and say, isn't this politics as usual? And hasn't he always already disavowed Reverend Wright? And why are we even talking about that? In fact, John Roberts, in Media Malpractice, they show a clip on CNN where John Roberts goes to Obama. He goes, this is a Reverend Wright free zone. We will not be covering this. So CNN is exactly as bad as MSNBC. And that goes down to Vox and Daily Kos and Mike. They're all far, far left sites. And I think CNN has somehow gotten away with being known as somewhat unbiased. But even Twitter is shooting very far to the left because they're petrified of Trump.
There's a bias everywhere. The idea of being unbiased is a joke. Every single person is biased. Some people are more towards bias in reality. Some people are more towards bias and distorted reality. And sadly, of course, the bought and paid for mainstream media system, they're biased towards warped reality.
But don't they seem like saboteurs? I mean, when you and me and Alex talk about stuff, we talk about things that are tangible, like $400 million going to Iran. When they talk about stuff, they are purposely censoring information. They are telling lies. So it's really propaganda versus just saying the facts. I mean, I'm happy to criticize Trump about a bunch of stuff, but they won't do that with Hillary. They won't do that with Obama.
It's always a lack of details. So you say, yes, you know, you're willing to criticize Trump. For example, though, someone could take a screenshot from the show of you wearing a Trump shirt and they could say, starch obsessed Trump supporter, right? But I bet, just like me, I could criticize a ton of things about Trump, right? I could criticize a ton of things. I could argue with myself and criticize myself, okay?
Yeah,
it's all about the details.
Charles Krauthammer said it. He goes, they think we're evil. We just think they're wrong. And I don't even believe in a difference of opinion. I don't think it's true. I think it's just one person having less facts than the other. But once you pile up all the facts, the truth becomes irrevocable. It's sitting right there in front of you. You can't just agree. If you agree to disagree, then it means one of you has given up on getting the facts.
It's also an issue of emotion versus facts too, right? Because look at the Rio Olympics. And the producer said that you had to head out here in a minute. Are you still good to go?
Yes, I do. I got
to
go.
Okay. All right, cool. Well, then I'll let you head off. But it reminds me of also Rio. Right? Because they say, oh, emotionally, it's like, well, we're going to give them a chance. It's amazing. It's going to be so fun. No, it's not. Everyone's getting robbed. There's a security risk. The police and fire are saying, don't come in here. You're going to die. It's a joke. It's emotion versus reality, and people are just getting played like a harp by the emotion system. Final comments before you got to head off, Gavin McInnes.
I would like to say, as an immigrant to America who has lived all over the world, I was born in England, I lived in China, I was raised mostly in Canada, I am honored to be here. And there, the level of ingratitude here, the number of ingrates, is downright embarrassing. I mean, when I saw Roots playing on Memorial Day, it made me want to go up to a vet and just apologize. These people are so ungrateful. These Americans are so ungrateful about this wonderful country we have, where we accept more immigrants than any other country in the world combined. We are more religiously tolerant. We treat gays better than anyone else. We treat women better than anyone else. And if you want to talk about Northern Europe, okay, let's talk about the entire West then. The point is that we are the most civilized and free, and we seem to be getting the most derision for it. I think that Americans need to go on a world tour and come back and kiss the ground they walk on, because it really is an honor being part of this country.
Very well said. Gavin McInnes, CompoundMedia.com. Thanks so much for joining. Had a good talking to you.
Thanks for having me.
All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to go into these Rio news. Chinese hurdler vomited on, robbed of luggage on first day. All these teams getting robbed and stuff like that. First, though, I did want to remind you that this extended sale at InfoWarsLife.com is probably going to have to be pulled down pretty soon, especially for Brainforce. Brainforce is selling out. You can get it for 40% off at InfoWarsLife.com. It's $17.76, down from $29.95, which is actually over 40% off. And, of course, since we've had that special going up when we extended it, we are going to sell out, and we're going to have to pull that special soon. So I wanted to read a couple of reviews from people. You can see all the five-star reviews on InfoWars Life. Just go and click the Brainforce page, scroll down, and click reviews. These are from just a couple here, from one from Johnny. I have used this product on recurring monthly orders. Love it. Auto ship. Also, you get an additional 10% off. So much more focus, mentally, and energy boost than I've felt for many years. I am now in my fourth bottle or order of Brainforce. It is a good product to keep on hand at all times. Then we've got David K. He says, definitely would recommend this product to keep a clear mind. I take this product before leaving for work, and it keeps me very alert with customers and helps to do my role very efficiently. The fact that it has natural ingredients is also a big plus, and I don't seem to have the big crashes I get from most stimulants out there. Yeah, absolutely. I agree. It's because it uses natural brain-activating ingredients. It does not load it with stimulants, right? It's not just junk. It's not like you're going to go to the convenience store and buy a very, very toxic energy drink, and you're going to get buzzed, and your head's going to feel like it's on fire, and then you're going to feel like crap afterwards. This actually has beneficial ingredients that your brain uses for many of its processes. We've also got 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion, which is the drink mix that really works. It's a multivitamin, and DNA Force, and site-wide free shipping at InfoWarsStore.com. So site-wide free shipping. This is an extended special. It is going to be taken down soon, especially for Brainforce. So if you want it 40% off, now is the time to get it. Let me tell you, I take 2 Brainforce in the morning, and it makes the difference. It is one of those products where every single time you meet a fan or something, they come up and they say, Brainforce, oh my God, it's amazing. It really is awesome. Now let's get into some of this. So, you know, we talk about all of this. We talk about these things. First and foremost, it's so important to understand when we talk about political incorrectness, we're voyaging into a path that very few people are willing to voyage into, because it's kind of like going into a forest. Some twigs and weird stuff's going to fall on you, and by the time you walk out of it, you're going to be covered in some junk, right? Well, that's what happens when you talk about these unmentionable subjects, right? When, like when we talk about in kindergarten, how these poor children are told, this is a black person, this is a white person. You see, most people aren't, you're not allowed to talk about that kind of stuff. But you see, we actually care because we want to progress humanity, and we don't want children to be turned into actual racists by showing them this is different, we're different, because we're really not different. And it's one of those things also that reminds me of the Rio Olympics. And I talk about this a lot because it's such a great perspective. Now, I feel very, very sad for all the people that live in Rio or in the area. And I feel bad for the athletes. Yes, they're highly paid, whatever, et cetera. But they are in Rio, and they've been told to close their mouths. They can't drink the water that they're swimming in. 2 teaspoons is enough to give you an infection. And all the anti-diarrhea medicine in the world is not going to save you, right? But instead of foreseeing all these problems, which many did, the officials at the Olympics, you know, they're just like, it's fine. It's going to be so safe. Like, it's going to be great. And it ties into what I was just talking about with Gavin. People that have never even been outside the country and seen true third world conditions, or I guess you can see very, very sad conditions in many places like Philadelphia, where I grew up. You could see horrible conditions, right? But a lot of people have never seen anything like that. And they think that the world is just some magical suburb where everyone gets deliveries from vitamin water and, you know, everyone's happy with Botox and smiling all the time. It's not the case. It's really a really vicious world out there, and we should be grateful for what we have. Wherever you are listening around the world, you know, there's a lot going on. Now, we talked about this at length, the hurdler that was vomited on, the Danish Olympic team hit by thieves. I mean, the media acts like it's unexpected. You're having a massive event in a country that's in turmoil, in an area that's totally, totally in turmoil. And this, stuff like this should be expected. Rio 2016, officials forced to cut their way into Olympic Stadium after losing keys to gate. So they couldn't even get in the gate. A BBC reporter in Rio de Janeiro captured the incident on video outside the stadium prior to Wednesday's women's football match between Sweden and South Africa. Two men described as firemen are seen using a pair of bolt cutters to break the padlock and open the gate. So there, maybe who even knows, you know, what kind of officials they are. They're just, oh, these are officials. I love that word, by the way. Don't worry. These are officials. When you hear the word officials, you just, oh, yes, absolutely. You could probably walk into a bank and say, I'm an official. I need all of the money in your storage, please, in the vaults. Give it over. And then this, as Rio games approach, 1.3 million tickets left unsold. I say good. That's great. You know why? Because the police and fire withholding the sign saying, don't come here. You're pretty much going to die. Maybe we should have listened to that. But you see, it kind of goes back into the whole tolerance thing and political correctness thing where it's bad to talk about how unsafe a place like this is. So in response, I am suggesting officially here on the Alex Jones Show, this is an official suggestion, that we hold the next Olympic Games in Juarez, Mexico. I believe it will be a great place for the Games. I believe it will, you know, just let's ignore all the safety implications, the fact that the violence is worse there than ever. You can basically see from the border just like mortars going off and fires, you know, craziness. Juarez, Mexico would be a great spot for the Olympic Games next time around. Of course, I'm kidding because it's highly unsafe and terrible, and it's not politically incorrect, I guess it is, to say that. Rio, clearly, 1.3 million tickets left unsold for good reason. We'll be right back. The Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Lots more to come. When you look at stories like this that we're about to cover, is that there's two different goals. One is to advance every single thing that we've worked for and advance humanity. And the second is to push humanity backwards and take control and try and dominate something that is really beautiful and has been such an amazing progress, right? So you look at this. First story is private company wins U.S. clearance to fly to the moon. I think this is an amazing thing. Florida-based company won U.S. government permission on Wednesday to send a robotic lander to the moon next year, the firm's founder said, making the first time the United States has cleared a private space mission to fly beyond Earth's orbit. The FAA unprecedented go-ahead for the Moon Express mission also sets a legal and regulatory framework for a host of other commercial expeditions to the moon, asteroids, and Mars. Great. We need more space exploration. NASA's budget is terrible. Pretty much, you look at Hillary Clinton, she doesn't want to expand the budget. A lot of candidates, for whatever reason, do not. NASA, regardless of your beliefs, clearly we need to go and we need to explore space, the wonders of the universe. There's so much out there. It's beautiful. Now, then look at this, right? Juxtaposition here. North Korea hopes to plant flag on the moon. This is from AP. And fortunately, AP, oh, printed, there we go. North Korean space officials are hard at work on a five-year plan to put more advanced satellite into orbit by 2020 and don't intend to stop there. They're also aiming for the moon and beyond. Now, what's funny is, key phrase there, it says, you know, they're working on advanced satellites into orbit by 2020. Gee, I wonder why that is. It couldn't be for military operations or anything like that. They just want to plant a flag on the moon. An interview with the Associated Press, a senior official at North Korea's version of NASA, said international sanctions won't stop the country from launching more satellites by 2020, and that he hopes to see the North Korean flag on the moon within the next 10 years. Even though the U.S. and its allies try to block our space development, our aerospace scientists will conquer space and definitely plant the flag of the DPRK on the moon. Yes, absolutely. It definitely has to do with the flag on the moon, like I said, and not any type of militaristic activity. But you see, there's one thing here. We want to explore space and find its mysteries and understand the universe better. There's so much that we don't know, right? Just imagine how much we don't know about the ocean. Well, times that by quadrillion in that space. And we want to expand, but at the same time, look at what's holding us back, right? Look at what's holding us back. Instead of putting the funding into that, instead of companies being created to launch these missions, companies instead have to focus on things like paying massive amounts of taxes and being screwed over. And also we have to remember that certain groups, you know, North Korea is too busy trying to launch satellites. And let's not remember this. This type of thing is also what's preventing us from leaping forward. Fed announced that Goldman Sachs has agreed to pay $36.3 million to settle allegations by the Federal Reserve that it obtained and used confidential regulatory materials from the central bank 2 years ago. What's that amount to? This amounts to 0.1% of the firm's 2015 revenue of $33.8 billion. And wow, the banks also make money from taxpayer dollars, $80-plus billion. Bloomberg said originally it was around that, and then I think it was 180, and then they released again that it was far more. So, you see, we can't go to space because the banks are looting everything, and they're getting away with it, and it's all a big joke, and then we're left to pay the bill. So there we go. But leaving on good news, Italy passed a law to encourage all supermarkets to give unsold food to the needy that'll feed 200 million people, and this is actually the answer to world hunger. So Italy's doing a great job feeding 200-plus million people. It's been an interesting show. Gavin McInnes was a very enjoyable discussion. Gave me some life advice as well. But stay tuned tomorrow for Alex to come back from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. It is a wild ride during these times. You don't want to miss it. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. This is The Alex Jones Show. Thank you.